Germany, the Netherlands, Japan, Israel, Finland, Portugal, France, Japan, Israel. Today, for the first time since John Finkel at Brussels in Belgium in the year 2000, today, America will have a Magic the Gathering world champion. Hello everyone, welcome to Seattle, welcome to PAX. We are live here at one of the world's great gaming conventions. We are at the home of Wizards of the Coast. It is great to have you with us around the world. Rich Hagen sitting alongside from Inside R&D, Jackie Lee. From the Hall of Fame, Mr. Louis Scott Vargas, and the Pro Tour historian, Mr. Brian David Marshall. It is great to have you with us. We have a ton to get through in the next hour or so, because that's how long we have until Semifinal 1 kicks into gear. And that will feature Seth Manfield up against Sam Black. But, boys and girls, I want to get, first of all, a little reflection on what we've seen so far. And if you like, a magic moment, what have we seen that you'll take away from PAX so far? Jackie, what about you?
For me, it was seeing the preview show last night with Will Wheaton and Ashley Birch. It was really exciting and rewarding to see so much cheering and excitement and just passion about the cards that I've helped work on a little bit since arriving in R&D.
Yeah, it was an extraordinary event. You will see that in its entirety a little about, probably about 5 minutes from now. Luis, how about you, your magic moment so far from Worlds 2015?
It was from one of my favorite matches, Yuya Watanabe against Sean McLaren, where Yuya stole Sean's Grim Lavamancer with Threads of Disloyalty, and then used Sean's Blood Moon to activate Grim Lavamancer for the last 2 points of damage on turn five of turns.
That was pretty brutal for sure. He is an utter master. And a lot of people will be very relieved not to have to face Yuya in the final four this weekend. Brian David Marshall, the historian. A lot of people got in at 9-5. One of the reasons that a lot of people got into the final four at 9-5 is because history happened.
Yeah, Seth Manfield just went on an incredible run at this event. He literally annihilated the field. We realized something special was happening with Seth Manfield when he 3-0'd the Modern Masters draft with his Abzan ramp deck and actually cast Ulamog the Infinite Gyre.
Yes.
Pretty ridiculous, and just you had a sense that something special was going on with him, and he just defeated Yuya Watanabe twice on day one, defeated Owen Turtenwald twice on day two, an incredible performance by someone that is just having the weekend of his life.
So we are heading towards just four people, and Seth Manfield is of course BDM our number one seed. But history's about a go, not right now. And right now, Seth Manfield is at 0-0 in the elimination bracket of Worlds.
Yeah, he's gonna be facing off against Sam Black. Mm-hmm. Seth's playing Abzan, which is not surprising given his team. They've been playing Abzan all year, but Sam Black is playing a pretty exciting deck. He's playing the Mono White Devotion deck, so
right.
I'm pretty excited to see that.
So Seth is our number one seed. Jackie, our number two seed coming in here is Owen Turtenwild. Tell us a little about Owen.
He's been preparing very hard for this tournament. I'm really excited to see what he can do in the top eight, given that he declared that he was going to win the tournament before it started. And, so far he hasn't really come short on his word. So I'm excited to see what he'll do with the kind of control slanted Abzan deck in the top four.
Yeah, there's lots of pretty interesting stuff coming out of Owen at the moment. He did a terrific interview this morning. You'll see that before his semi-final. He has some really interesting things to say about the game and about Magic in his life. All right, Luis, number three seed, and this is Owen's opponent in semi-final two later this afternoon. This is Paul Rietzel.
Yeah, Paul's someone who I was the most happy to see get into the Hall of Fame. I had been hoping Paul would get in for years. He finally hit a fourth Pro Tour top eight, and that really pushed him over the top. I even lost to him playing for top eight in one of those Pro Tour top eights. But despite that, I've been very happy to see him be successful. And it'd be awesome if Paul took it down.
Yeah, and this is one of his career goals. It is his last career goal. He stated, if I could be world champion, I would feel that my suite of excellence is complete. A Pro Tour champion in the Hall of Fame, world champion. That would be the trinity. Job done. It'd be great to see. All right, and from my point of view, well, I can't wait to see Sam Black in action. As BDM's already said, White Devotion is his list. We've seen Girapur Aether Grid was the card of the weekend in many ways, and so typical of Sam. A card that you have to spend hours trawling through Gatherer to even find, much less find a home for. And of course, Sam's been doing that for year after year after year. It's great to see him put his deck building chops to great use on the biggest stage of all. All right, so all that is still to come. Two semifinals will have Manfield against Black, followed by Turtenwild against Rietzel. But right now, we're going to send you off to the Battle for Zendikar preview show because, as Jackie said, it really was one of the highlights of the weekend. Will Wheaton, Ashley Birch, cast of thousands, and an audience of what felt like tens of thousands. It was crammed in here last night. So what we're going to do is send you over to that. We will see you right back here as we kick into high gear for the World Championship. But first of all, take a look at this.
That was smashing.
Our world is a place of beauty and danger. It is equal parts adventure and disaster. It is Zendikar, our home. And it is under siege. Monsters have emerged everywhere. Some say they have been here all along, trapped. But I say they are not of this world. And it is we who are trapped. They are spreading across Zendikar, killing and consuming. Left unchallenged, they will leave our home, a wasteland. But Zendikar has its defenders, heroes who fight to save this world from the forces that threaten to destroy it. We all must find strength in one another. Only then can Zendikar be saved. Now is the time to face this alien threat, to take a stand, to battle for Zendikar.
If you're excited now, just wait. Hello, PAX! And the internet, which I imagine isn't going to cheer as loudly. I'm Will Wheaton. Hello!
Yay, Will Wheaton! And I'm Ashley Birch. Thanks, everyone, for coming here, and for those of you that are joining us at home for the Battle for Zendikar preview show!
It is very appropriate that we were having the preview show in this area because it looks an awful lot like Zendikar in here. I've actually been there to the actual Zendikar, and it looks very, very similar to this.
It's weird, right? There's these giant hedrons that are just bursting out of the ground over here.
Yeah, we've got one over here that's like 9 feet tall, which I guess is life size for a hedron,
yeah,
I think.
That's accurate.
I think,
yeah.
Wow, that's a thing that's happening.
Eldrazi!
That also happens on the real Zendikar.
We've got Kor swinging from vines in the entrance. That's pretty sweet.
Yep, and then we have this great, amazing, giant Eldrazi tentacle bursting out of the ground out front and crushing a police car.
Which is okay, I guess.
Yeah, like, tap the police, I guess.
Right, exactly.
It's a cultural reference that mixes pop culture with magic.
Let's explain. So back in the 90s.
Joke is very funny. And seriously, as cool as all of this stuff is, it's not the only stuff that's going on here this weekend. We got the Magic World Championship happening downstairs right now. Tomorrow afternoon, you can watch the finals in person if you are here. You can watch it on our Twitch channel if you are not here. Although I guess if you're here, you could watch it in person and on Twitch.
Oh, man. And then
you would know what's going to happen before it hits Twitch.
And then the singularity would happen.
Yeah.
And we all get sucked into a black hole.
Yeah. So that's a thing that you can do.
That's a thing you can do. There's also a lot of awesome panels happening this weekend. We've got the world-building panel for the Battle of Zendikar on
Monday in the Hydra Theater.
Yes.
We also got all the awesome stuff happening in the Seagate Theater downstairs. Mm-hmm. There's a panel about how to be a professional Magic player, which is super cool, a character design panel, and a Q&A with Mark Rosewater himself.
Yeah, and, it's kind of awesome.
Yeah, which is kind of awesome. And again, if you're not going to be here in person for whatever reason, then we're going to put all this stuff, we're going to record it and put it up on the Wizards website and our YouTube channel. So
there's also a whole bunch of Learn to Play Magic events. There are some Magic game shows, and we are having drafts firing all weekend long. So it's pretty cool. So that's all the stuff that's happening here at PAX in general. But what is happening here in our version of Zendikar specifically?
We're going to look at Zendikar and find out that things are not going super well there right now. Spoiler alert.
No, they're really not.
Things they're not good.
Things are not going well there at all. I represented the Eldrazi hordes just a little bit ago. We were doing our best to make things really bad on Zendikar.
You're the worst.
But I was kind of great at it. I went 4-3, not bad. The Allies deck, I could say a swear about, because I hate fighting against that. But Zendikar defeated the Eldrazi hordes. Congratulations, Zendikar. We're all very proud of you. Sort of, I guess. And in the course of defeating the Eldrazi, we revealed a whole bunch of preview cards for the people who are here. We put some of them online, but we are going to show them all again while we are here today in more detail. And we are going to talk all about them and Battle for Zendikar specifically with Mark Rosewater, who will be on here this stage in just a minute.
Yeah.
I'm going to go find Mark
to make that happen. That's a good idea.
So, bye.
Bye. Good luck. I'll be here alone and sad. So before we share Battle of Zendikar, the set, with you guys, we wanted to talk a little bit more about Zendikar, the place. So to do that, please welcome Doug Beyer. He is the senior game designer at Magic the Gathering. Welcome, Doug.
Hi.
So what is Zendikar, Doug?
So let's start with the basics here. So Zendikar is one of the worlds of the multiverse.
Mm-hmm.
It's one we were excited to return to. Because this is a place where, last time we visited, there was a bit of a cliffhanger to the story. We didn't know what happened with the Eldrazi. So now, we're returning to this place of extreme landscapes, amazing geography, survivors and explorers who stop at nothing to survive in this extreme environment.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a place that has deep history. It has a history that's built around these magical hedrons that you're seeing around the stage here. This is the place where these explorers search through these ruins to find hidden treasures and delve into ancient secrets.
Ooh, secrets. Do we get to know about the secrets?
You want to know about some secrets?
Do you guys want to know about the secrets?
All right.
Please tell us about the secrets.
So set the Wayback Machine to 6,000 years ago.
Okay.
We're going deep, guys. So at the time, the Eldrazi, which are these astral, cosmic abominations from beyond the bland eternities, have been ravaging the multiverse. They're a threat to every plane. Wherever the Eldrazi go, they consume, they destroy, they feed on life, energy, mana, anything, they turn it to dust. So they were a threat to so many worlds that ancient planeswalkers banded together and decided to trap the Eldrazi. But they needed a place, they needed a world where they could bring the Eldrazi and make sure they could trap them there. They chose Zendikar.
Why did they choose Zendikar?
So Zendikar's potent mana was a perfect lure for the Zendikar. It drove them right in. They wanted to feed on its energies anyway. And it worked. They constructed this massive spell to bind the Eldrazi. And the Hedrons essentially sent them into a state of torpor. And so they rested. And things calmed down for thousands of years.
OK, so we're good then. We can all go home. We're good?
Well, no.
No, okay, that's what I thought.
The problem is, inadvertently, planeswalkers fast forward 6,000 more years now. We're in the current era.
Okay.
Got it? All right.
Yes.
Some planeswalkers inadvertently loosened the bonds that kept the Eldrazi trapped. That's what the Rise of the Eldrazi set represented. They rose up out of the earth. They scrabbled across the landscape. They began feeding on Zendikar and its mana and its energy. We saw the Titan Ulamog, this mighty titan, move across the landscape, leaving a swath of destruction, creating, spawning new monsters as it went. And they're tearing across the landscape, leaving this sort of chalky, dusty wasteland in their wake.
That's super sad.
That's sort of sad.
I'm really bummed out now.
But there's going to be some upside. So there is hope. Fortunately, we have people coming together to rise up against the Eldrazi. There are heroes from Zendikar who are standing up, who are coming from all walks of life. Goblins and elves and Khor, vampires, humans, they're all coming together to fight against the Eldrazi. And the land itself is fighting back. The land of Zendikar acts as a kind of immune system. It can sense the threat of the Eldrazi, and it's rising up, creating massive elementals to fight against the Eldrazi too. Finally, some planeswalkers are here, and they've come to lead the charge, to bring together all these forces of the Zendikari people to battle back the Eldrazi, to hope to save this world. They know that if the Eldrazi conquer Zendikar, then the Eldrazi will be a threat to every world, so they need to stop it here. So, we have Gideon and Jura in particular. Gideon is an ally of Zendikar. He is bringing together all the forces of Zendikar, and he's going to use his leadership abilities to muster. Oh,
Look at this. Look at these chiseled abs. You can just tell.
I mean, there's a lot of handsome going on here. There's also a card. I mean, we're not showing it right now.
Do you guys want to see the abs or the card?
Unless you guys want to see the card. All right, here we go.
We'll show you the card.
We'll show you the card.
Abs later. So, yeah, right? Yeah, okay. So Gideon's an ally, and he makes other allies.
That's right.
And he makes everyone stronger.
He's very powerful in this way. You're gonna see a little later on in the show how this clicks in with the mechanics of the set very powerfully.
Yeah, he seems pretty awesome.
He's pretty awesome.
Pretty excited about this.
So we've seen a lot of these beautiful landscapes of Zendikar. We've heard some of the lore behind the story that's led up to this point. Mm-hmm. And as a member of the creative team, I'm just so proud of all the work that went into bringing all these elements together, these talented individuals who've created and forged this world of Zendikar.
You should be. It's awesome. Art's beautiful. Everything's great.
So it's super excited. Hey.
Excuse me. Just wondering if I could interrupt.
Hey, Graham.
Hey, Graham Stark, Loading Ready Run. Hi, everybody.
Hey, Graham.
Don't worry that I'm conspicuously mic'd. Doug, I've been coming to the world-building panels at PAX for the last, I want to say 4 years, yep. Asking the same question every time.
I know you have. I've been at most of those.
Yeah, and Magic is a game with beautiful, gorgeous art, and especially for Zendikar. Doug, when can we buy an art book?
January 5th.
Wait, really?
How's your heart?
I'm so excited right now.
Okay. I'm proud to announce The Art of Magic the Gathering Zendikar, yes. Which is an amazing lore book that's full of hundreds of illustrations from the original set, Battle for Zendikar, and the next set. It contains over 60,000 words of lore, behind-the-scenes information about the setting and this world, bringing together everything that you will need to bring Zendikar to life.
Do you have one on you?
Yes, I do. And it looks like this. I'm kind of protective of it.
Can I touch it?
No.
Okay. Sorry, Graham.
That's okay. It's okay. I'll go back over here now.
Doug Bear, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fire. Thank you.
Okay, but seriously, that art book.
I know, right?
Right?
I'm so excited. The art's so beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is so awesome. So, after everything that Doug just told us, I'm really excited to play this set.
Yep.
But, just walk with me for a moment into the realm of the hypothetical.
All right.
If I am a Magic Duels player?
That is a very interesting and, as it turns out, not entirely hypothetical question that we created to give us an opportunity to talk about this very thing.
Isn't that weird?
Yes. So, Magic player, you will be very happy to know, all you Magic Duels players, that there will be a brand new Battle for Zendikar campaign in Magic Duels. It will be free to download, and you can unlock Battle for Zendikar boosters by spending coins or buying coins in the game.
Woo! Right? Nice. So if you are not a Magic Duels player yet, it is free to download and it is available on iOS, Xbox One, and PC via Steam right now if you want to, you know, go play some Magic on the computer.
Oh, you know what just happened is I just felt the collective butthole of the legal department go because I said buying and what I meant was earning. And I said the wrong word. So by buying, I meant earning.
That made my butthole feel weird.
That's what I meant.
Everyone's everything.
Yes, so legal, you can relax. Just relax your buttholes, legal department. Oh, wait a minute. Corporate butthole just went like this because I said legal butthole. Oh, you guys, it is a bad day for buttholes here in Seattle.
Speaking of buttholes.
Yeah.
I mean, new cards.
Yes.
They're kind of the same thing.
Right.
Right. Did you find Mark?
In fact, I did.
Okay.
I found Mark. Mark Rosewater, why don't you come on out here and talk the Magic the Gathering? I had so much fun playing as an Eldrazi this afternoon.
It seems to match your personality, so.
You know what, it kind of does a little bit. I'm kind of always the villain. I'm clearly on Team Tentacle. And here's the thing about the Eldrazi, you guys, okay? They just want to eat. It's not that big a deal. Stop trying to lock them up in a box and just let them go out and eat. They're gonna devour everything, but that's okay. Let's talk about the super annoying heroes that are trying to stop the Eldrazi from just running out and having the snack that they've needed for literally thousands of years. Let's get started with some of the cards that we revealed during our event this afternoon.
Okay.
And then I understand we have some other kind of awesome stuff to talk about.
So let's jump in.
Yeah, let's go.
So one of the cool things about going back to a place is that you want to get a balance between revisiting it and bringing back things people loved about why we were there before, but not rehashing it completely, doing some new things. And so we were trying to get a balance. So one of the things that's really important is we're back in Zendikar, the Eldrazi are there. Your friends, the Eldrazi.
They're really good guys.
So the key is, how do you represent the Eldrazi? So there were five things that we mechanically wanted to do. So number one, they are ancient beings. They are old. They are old, old, old. They are one of the oldest things in the multiverse. Number two, they're huge. They're giant creatures. Number three, they're alien. They're unfathomable. They're really good villains because no one understands what they're doing. You can't reason with them. You can't really plan what they're, you have no idea what they're doing. They're so alien.
Has anybody even really tried to talk to them?
Number four.
Exactly. Hashtag
four.
Not all Eldrazi.
So number four is, the Eldrazi are not just individual beings, they're all interconnected. That they're one larger entity that we have to understand how they all work together. And number five, they're voracious. They're hungry.
Yes. I know. as their anointed representative on the stage, I can tell you that is true.
So we wanted to capture them. So let's look at the cards and we'll talk about how we did that.
Okay, so we'll start with a card that I actually got to play this afternoon in one of the matches that I won. By the way, I went 4-3. Very proud of myself. This is
7-4.
This is the, all right. That's true. I would hope that you are better than me at this game.
My boss went undefeated, by the way, so.
That's nice.
Yeah.
I guess he didn't have to face that ally deck. Super not bitter about that ally deck. This card is amazing. This is the Eldrazi Devastator, all right? This guy is freaking huge, all right? So he's an 8/9 with trample, but he's a common.
He's a common.
For 8. Explain how this craziness happens.
Well, we're back in Zendikar for starters. So, first off, I said the Eldrazi are ancient. How do we show that they're ancient? Well, they're so old that they predate the colors of magic. Now, the colors of magic are a key part of magic. These guys are so old, they pre-exist that. So, one of the things we did last time we saw them is they were colorless. So we have a special frame, and that they are, one of the things we wanted to do is really show how using the colorless as a means to sort of represent them all. We'll get to that. Also, they're huge. How do we show they're huge? We make them huge. It's an 8/9 trampler at common. We don't do that normally. So, you know, one of the things that's fun about going to Zendikar is you get to see the Eldrazi. You get to see giant 8/9 tramplers. All right, so the next card that we have is Kozilek's Channeler. Right? Now, this is very interesting because usually cards that make mana are a little smaller.
Yes.
Right, so what?
Okay, so normally in Magic we have what we call mana elves, which are one or two drop creatures that produce mana.
Mm-hmm.
So this guy, his playtest name was Eldrazi, because he was an Eldrazi version of a mana elf. We couldn't keep it, but so one of the things that's neat about this card is it costs 5 mana, it's 4/4, taps for 2 colorless. Well, why would you need that? Well, we just saw why, because the last guy costs 8 to cast, and so you need them. So the Eldrazi all work together, that they're interconnected, and so one of the fun things about doing this is having the Eldrazi help each other. So this guy helps get the really big Eldrazi out. And we talked about how they're really alien, that, you know, an Eldrazi, you know, a man of Eldrazi is very different from a normal thing. So we get to show how different it is.
So here's one that is super different. This is the Barrage Tyrant. This is another Eldrazi character. Now, okay, this card is super awesome. The frame is amazing, and the frame tells a story which I really, really like. So I'm going to step out of the way and let them understand why I am this stupidly excited about this card. Go.
Okay, so I said that when you go back to a world, you want to bring back things you know, but you also want new things, you want different things. So one of the things, last time we were there in Rise of the Eldrazi, we met them. Most of them were colorless, but a few of them were colored. There were red, black, and green Eldrazi. I'm like, okay, we're back now. The Eldrazi like to eat mana. Okay, no colored Eldrazi. Everything's going to be colorless. And so that was the plan. But, you know, we've been doing this a long time, 22 years of Magic. We learned some lessons. So once upon a time, we had a set called Mirrodin. And if you make a lot of colorless things, you get in trouble because the color pie is a safety net. It protects you. It's good. It protects you, and you need it. And that when you make too many colorless things, everything gets to go on the same deck, and it gets broken.
Yeah, which, by the way, was awesome. I love Mirrodin.
So what happened was we needed to have a way to make everything colorless, but have the color pie matter. So we had way back in Future Sight, there was a card from the future, apparently now, and it's a card that was a Ghostfire that had a mana cost that cost color, but it was colorless.
Mm-hmm.
And so we said, oh, that is a good idea. That's how we can have colorless creatures, but have them be colored. But the problem was, how do you represent that? We need a frame. And so we worked on it, and what we did is, you notice at the top part is like red, like a normal red card. So when it's in your hand, you can see that you need red mana for it. But once you get it out in play, the rest of it is colorless, because in play, it's a colorless creature. And so the frame does a really nice job explaining that. Now, the other cool thing, you look here, its ability is you can spend 2 in a red, sacrifice another colorless creature, and then it deals damage equal to that creature's power to target creature or player. So one of the themes about colorlessness is we can make colors matter. So one of the big things in the set is the Eldrazi are all colorless, and we have all these different cards, like the Barrage Tyrant, that make colorless matter. And the cool thing about that is, in this set, in Limited, it's all about the Eldrazi. But if you get to Standard, what was the last block about? Morph! Face down colorless creatures. So this matters in this set in one way, and in Standard it matters in a whole different way.
It's just so pretty, you guys. Like, it's so great that when you play this, the Eldrazi just destroys the mana and leaves nothing behind. I love that. It's really great. And I just... All right, I get it. You don't like it the way I do. That's fine. You're wrong. It's great. Another Eldrazi is called the Incubator Drone.
Yes.
And this is another creature with Devoid. Mm-hmm. So talk us through this card.
Okay, so if you remember back last time we saw the Eldrazi, they had the Eldrazi Spawn, which were 0/1 colorless creature tokens that you could sack for colorless mana. So the Eldrazi like to work together. The Spawn were a way to get mana so you could cast the big creatures. Well, they're back. Kind of, hey, some time's elapsed, the Spawn have gotten better. Now they're Scions. The Scions are not 0/1 creatures, they're 1/1 creatures. So before, if you wanted to win with Spawn, you had to beef them up, you had other cards that had to help you. You don't need that with the Scions, you get enough Scions out, they alone can win.
The next card that we're going to see is the Mist Intruder. I don't know why I'm looking there, I could look right here. The next card is the Mist Intruder.
let's just forget I said that. The Mist Intruder. So this is another Eldrazi drone that has Devoid and is flying, but it's got this new thing called Ingest, which is awesome. Talk about Ingest.
Okay, so one of the things, what Ingest means is a creature with Ingest, whatever deals combat damage to another player, you take the top card of their library and you exile it. Now, in a vacuum, you can, you know, you can mill out your opponent, you can deplete their library, but it actually is part of a much larger strategy. So one of the things we're trying to do is we want the Eldrazi to be strange and weird, and we also want them to be voracious. How do we do that? So one of the themes we do in the set is the Eldrazi are all about exiling things. They have lots and lots of different ways to exile things. Why is that important? Because of a new thing called Eldrazi processors.
I imagine that there's probably a processor coming up next, almost as if we planned this.
Oh, look!
No, look at that! It's the Blightherder, an Eldrazi processor! Explain the Blightherder, which is terrifying to look at. That art is super disturbing to me.
So what processors do is other cards will get things into the exile zone, and then when processors enter the battlefield, they can eat stuff out of the exile zone, ends up going into the opponent's graveyard, so they can do things. This card, for example, will make three Scion tokens. So all of a sudden, the Eldrazi, they get to eat things in play, and then they get to eat things in the exile zone. And we've never really messed in the space. It's really alien space. Well, we have an alien people. We want to mess in alien space. So this is really brand new design space.
And I'm telling you, when you are facing these guys in a battle, I will just ask you to please remember this all could have been avoided if you had just let them out to eat. That's all they want to do. The next card we're looking at is an instant. Yes. But this is crazy. This is a colorless instant.
Yes.
And this does not happen very often in Magic. In my research for this, and by research I mean talking to Graham on the phone, it's happened four times.
Yeah, so what happened is, last time we saw the Eldrazi, we introduced the idea of colorless instant sorceries.
Yeah.
They didn't exist. The Eldrazi are the only time we've ever done them. Well, they're back, so colorless sorceries are back. Now this card does a really good job of explaining all the pieces of how the Eldrazi come together. So Titan's Present costs three. As an additional cost, you can cast Titan's Present, you reveal a creature card, a colorless creature card from your hand, and then you exile target creature if its power is equal to or less than the power of the creature you revealed. Okay, so I said they're ancient. This is a colorless instant. I said that they're gigantic. Well, you want to reveal a really big creature from your hand. I said that they're alien. This is a very weird card doing strange things. I said they're voracious. They're exiling creatures. And I said they all work together. Well, why are they exiling creatures? Because the processors are going to eat them. So this is a really good example of how the Eldrazi mechanically are all intertwined to
like
do...
You can create a great feedback loop with your Eldrazi creatures that make your opponent really not have a good day.
Well, if you want to play the Eldrazi, you can do a lot of damage to your opponent.
We're going to see some of the good guys now, I guess. The heroes, whatever, they're on the wrong side of this battle. This is the Oren Reef Hydra. So it's not an Eldrazi, and it's freaking huge. Introduce us to the Oren Reef Hydra.
Okay, so the Oren Reef Hydra, it's a 6-mana creature, 5/5 trampler, and it brings back landfall. So, okay, so when we were in Zendikar last time, the number one mechanic was landfall. So when we knew we were coming back, we're like, okay, we want to make sure we have new things, but we want to bring stuff back. Well, this was the most popular mechanic. So we brought it back, we put the Zendikari side gets it, and we did some twists to it. So this card, for example, besides being landfall, it's kind of also forest fall. It rewards you for having a forest, because you get 1+1 counter for a land, but you get 2 for a forest. And so what you'll see is landfall's back, but we've done some new things to twist it up a little bit.
You know, I loved landfall in Zendikar in 2009. I thought it was great until I had to actually defend against it today. and the guy that wrecked me before I could touch him, his creature was nominally a 1-1 creature. But thanks to landfall, by the time it was over, I was at -8 and he was at 43. So... maybe I don't love...
You don't like allies.
Don't like allies. Don't like landfall. Okay. No, I like big creatures that destroy everything and make you cry. I mean, that's sort of my jam a little bit. We're going to see another hero. This is the hero of Gomafada, right? So now we know that allies are back, and he's an ally, but he has this right who said yes. You're right. This guy is... this guy's great. He's on the wrong side, and I'm disappointed about that, but he's super amazing. So talk us through this and explain Rally, because Rally's really cool.
Okay, so last time we were in Zendikar, the allies were very, very popular. So when we So remember, when Zendikar started out, it was Adventure World. And what the Allies originally represented was the idea of an adventuring party. That, you know, Zendikar had all these treasures in it, and the parties gathered together to hunt through Zendikar and find these. But when the Eldrazi came, they had to band together to fight the Eldrazi. Well, now we're back. They're in trouble, and this is the army defending Zendikar. Zendikar's in deep, deep trouble, and the only thing that stands between Zendikar and a big snack for the Eldrazi is the Allies. And so what Rally is we took a mechanic we had done last time without a name, we didn't name it last time, and we tweaked it a little bit. So previously, if you look at ally decks from old Zendikar, whenever this creature, which is always an ally, or another ally enters the battlefield under your control, it generates an effect that affects other allies. But Rally affects not just all allies, but all your creatures. Because one of the things we realized is, ally decks want you to play more allies, but we don't want to punish you for having all allies. You can have some non-ally creatures in your deck. And so Rally is sort of a tweaked version of the ally mechanic.
So that's super awesome until I have to face a guy who's got his freaking landfall and his 1-1 guys and this guy, too. So thanks for nothing. Up next is Radiant Flames. So yeah. Radiant Flames is a sorcery with a new mechanic called Converge.
Yes.
Tell us about Converge.
Okay, so what we said is the Eldrazi are all about colorlessness, so we wanted to contrast them. Obviously, the Zendikar are fighting the Eldrazi, so they're about color. So what Converge says is whenever you cast a Converge spell, it's a variable effect. It looks at how much colored mana you spent. So for example, take Radiant Flames. If you spend 2 colorless mana and 1 red, well, it'll do 1 damage to everything. But let's say you spend a white mana and a blue mana and a red mana to cast it, it'll do 3 damage. That's a scalable effect based on how much color you have. And so the Eldrazi lets you do a lot of cool things with colorlessness. The Zendikar lets you do cool things with color.
So how are you feeling about this so far, Pax? I hope that's what you would say. Let's look at Ruinous Path.
Okay, so okay. The Zendikari aren't the only ones on their side. There's one other ally that they have.
Yep.
Zendikar itself, the land we learn is sentient. It doesn't really like the Eldrazi. And so we have Awaken. So what Awaken says is, let's look at Ruinous Path. Costs 1 black for a sorcery. You can destroy a target creature or planeswalker. Pretty awesome. But for Awaken, so Awaken always has a number. That number can vary. Awaken 4 means if you spend extra mana, you get to turn a land into a 0/0 creature and put that many +1/+1 counters on it. So Awaken 4 means essentially you turn a land into a 4/4 creature. So you get a creature to either attack with, to block with, whatever you want to do, but you can spend extra mana to also animate your land to fight for you.
Now, speaking as the appointed representative of the Eldrazi here on the stage, okay, as we've established earlier, I am super freaking excited to share with everyone who was not here earlier, who does not already know this, that our good friend Ulamog is back.
Yes.
That Ulamog is returning, everyone. He is our master. He is our benevolent destroyer. He is freaking amazing. And he is back as Ulamog the Ceaseless Hunger.
Yes.
Please now introduce these sad Zendikari to their future destruction.
So what we learned is there were originally 3 Titans. The one Titan remaining is Ulamog. He was known for, he loves to eat.
Yeah.
He really, really likes to eat.
Yeah.
And so we made a 10 mana, 10/10 indestructible creature. When you cast him, he exiles 2 permanents. So even if you counter him, he still exiles 2 permanents. And then whenever he attacks, the defending player exiles the top 20 cards of their library.
So he's so awesome!
So what we knew is, look, he's the villain. You have to have a good villain. So we made a really good villain.
And the villain being the hero of his own story, all he wants to do is get rid of all the cards in your library so you will go away. I don't think that's unreasonable. We've met a lot of creatures and some sorceries and things like that, but one of the things that you had talked about is the land of Zendikar.
Yeah.
And Zendikar being a realm with a very strong land theme. So, I imagine
imagine that the kids would be pretty happy to know that Full Frame Land is back.
So previously I talked about how the most popular mechanic of the original Zendikar was landfall.
Yes.
But in our market survey, the actual mechanic that won the survey was full art land.
Yeah.
So we're back in Zendikar. We say, you know what? We need to do full art land. Zendikar's all about the land.
Yeah.
And so it's back. This is a cycle done by an artist named Tinhua Shu, and it is shows you kind of what where Zendikar is now.
Yep.
We get to see some of the lush Zendikar, a little bit of the destroyed Zendikar, mm-hmm. And you get to see all that Zendikar has to offer.
How do I get these cards?
How do you get these cards?
Yeah.
Open up booster packs.
Okay, very good.
They're
good
basic land, so you can get them in any pack.
Okay, great. On your Tumblr, mm-hmm. you had mentioned some other land-related things.
I did.
Would you like to talk a little bit about your land-related things that we might want to look at maybe on this screen right now?
So, what I said was we were doing a brand new cycle of rare dual lands, mm-hmm. and I said I think you guys were going to like them. So did you guys want to see the dual lands? Yeah! Okay, so why don't we take a look at the dual land? Okay, so let me explain. So these are... okay, this is... okay. Okay, so let me explain real quickly, because those at home might not get it as quick as you guys do. What's going on here is these lands come and play untapped as long as you have two or more basic lands. They were designed that way, so they play really well in 2 and 3 color decks, but aren't as strong in 4 and 5 color decks. But the most important part is the card type line. They have basic land types. What does that mean? That means they play really nicely with the fetch lands from Khans of Tarkir. They allow you to go get other colors with your fetch lands.
Now, they have a special expansion symbol on them, right?
No, not these do not.
Oh, the ones we're going to see next have a special expansion symbol on them.
You're hinting at something to come.
Oh, dear me, I seem to have jumped into the future where I'm from and brought back this question.
Yes.
These are great, all right? I love them, and I don't want to appear ungrateful. But wouldn't these be neat if they were like, I don't know, full frame maybe?
What? What? Funny you would ask that. So, we know that Zendikar is a land of treasures.
Yes.
So we've done a special promotion called Zendikar Expeditions.
Yes.
So what it is, it's 25 non-basic lands.
Yes.
All done in full frame art. So let's take a look at one of these in there. Okay, so here, let me explain. They are full frame art, brand new art, all set on Zendikar. They have a special frame that's a special Zendikari frame. They're all premium. They are in English. They appear in non-English product, but only in English versions. It will not be on Magic Duels, but it will be on Magic Online, but not redeemable.
Now, they seem to have a special symbol on them. Which is very surprising to me. That was not a thing I was anticipating at all. Would you talk about their special expansion symbol that I've just now noticed?
Okay, so one.
Not that I got a thing messed up from rehearsal at 6 o'clock this morning, but I literally just noticed right now.
So one of the things about this is Zendikar Expeditions. Battle for Zendikar boosters.
Yes.
They're not officially part of the Battle for Zendikar set. They're a special thing added in.
Okay.
And so they have their own expansion symbol. So when you're collecting, for example, in Magic Online, you don't need to get the expeditions to redeem the set. They're not officially part of the set.
And these are in boosters.
These are in boosters, yes.
And I'm going to go out on a limb here and guess that they're relatively rare.
They are.
So how rare are they?
They are equal in rarity to premium mythic rares.
Oh, just that.
But because there's 25 of them and there's only 15, mm-hmm. you actually open them slightly more often than you open up a premium mythic rare.
If I get a booster pack and I get one of these amazing lands, can I use it right away?
If you're playing in limited, you can. If you're playing in draft or sealed, yes, you can. In okay. constructed, you can play them in any format that they're legal.
Okay.
For example, we just saw the dual lands from Battle for Zendikar. Obviously, those are available in standard. You can play them in standard.
One of the things that I saw as I was standing very close to the screen here and noticing for the very first time that they have a special expansion symbol is that it is an edition of 45?
Okay, yes.
What does that mean?
Zendikar Expeditions is not just for Battle for Zendikar, but the entire Battle for Zendikar block. So what that means is there are 25 in Battle for Zendikar, and then 20 new ones in Sweat. We haven't released the name yet, in the small expansion. So 25 in the first set, 20 different ones in the second set.
Okay, so five of the 25 expeditions are in Battle for Zendikar.
Yes.
What are the other 20?
What are the other 20? Well, I can't tell you just
Damn
now.
Damn it!
But I will say there are two 10-card cycles that I think the players will like.
Hey, I have a question. I'm a player. And we kind of work for the same company right now. So, like, maybe you could just tell me what some of them are.
Please? I'm sorry. I'm only allowed to tell things they say I can say, so I can't. But when you guys find out, you will like them. Just trust, you will like them.
I tried. This is amazing, and this is so exciting, and I think everyone will probably join me in saying thank you, Mark, not just for this, but for everything with Magic. Thank you
okay,
so
well,
much.
Thank you.
Hey, so just so you guys know, those are premium foil mythic rare cards. So just for clarification, premium foil mythic rare. So
wait, did you say they're premium foil
premium
mythic
foil
rare?
Premium foil mythic rare.
I am excited.
No, I'm excited.
But I am also excited.
No, I'm the most excited.
Okay, I believe you. You're the most excited.
This
Ash is
awesome.
Excited, everybody. Yay! You're my little Ulamog. Hooray!
That's right.
You
don't
sure
cross
are.
Me.
Nope, I won't.
This is awesome, yeah?
Yeah, so this was really super great.
Yeah, so, okay, everyone that's joining us at home, if you're watching from home, make sure to tune in again right here tomorrow for the finals for the Magic World Championship.
Yeah, and to find out even more about Zendikar, you can go to the Magic World Building Panel, which will be here at PAX on Monday in the theater. I'm going to look down here so I don't get it wrong. It will be streamed on twitch.tv/magic, so if you can't be here, or if you're here and you need to be standing in line for something else, you'll be able to see it and find out all about it.
And check out battleforzendikar.com to find out when and where you can play Battle for Zendikar for yourself.
And this was awesome.
Yeah, it was really fun.
I really enjoyed it.
I did too.
Yeah, so thanks a lot for coming out tonight, everybody.
Yeah.
And for being part of this event.
Yes.
And for helping us get ready for the next step in the Battle for Zendikar.
Yeah, it's very exciting.
Did you have any thoughts about what you think the Magic Expeditions might be?
Oh, Mark didn't tell you?
No, I was literally just talking to him out here and tried to get him to tell me and he wouldn't say anything.
Oh, that's really embarrassing because he told me.
What?
Yeah. Do you want to see a couple?
Yes.
They're so cool! Will's gonna have a heart attack, so... Are you okay? Do we need to call a doctor?
No, I'm great. Thank you very much for coming, everybody. Play more games.
That's the end of the show.
There's some very, very happy people there, Jackie Lee.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I think the thing I love most about those full art basic lands, you know, like the full art island, do you know what it does? It taps for blue mana.
Which is a great ability, to be fair.
Pretty much the, yes, am I right, Pax? The best ability of all time, tap blue. All right, so welcome along. That's all the fun from the Battle for Zendikar previews. We are now full on into World Championship mode. Rich and Jackie here with you to talk you through our first semi-final. And we're gonna kick off by looking at our overnight leader, Seth Manfield. He dominated the tournament, 13-1. Let's take a look at Seth Manfield for you. So he comes in, as we say, as our number one seed. There you see him. He's currently the number four ranked player in the world. That's going to rise. 157 lifetime pro points. So's that. One for every round in the Swiss. Two for every win today. So another four on the line. And that 55,000 lifetime earnings, he could essentially double that by the end of the day. Five Grand Prix top eights. What is very noticeable from those five top eights, well, you might hope to win one of those five. He's won three of the five. He is a great closer, and he has dominated the tournament thus far. Why don't we take a look at his records across the four formats. So there you see, 3 for 3 in Modern Masters 2015, 3 of 4 in Modern, 3-0 again in Limited for Magic Origins, and then just the 4-0 in Standard. So really just pretty terrible at Modern, apparently. So that's Seth Manfield by format. Jackie, what about his round-by-round record? Why don't we take a look at who he actually faced and what stands out to you there?
Yeah, so what strikes me is X1. We were talking on Friday about how X4 is quite a good record in this
tremendous
small tournament of 24 players. Yeah, he dropped a single match, and he even, like, was, he lost 1-2, right? So, I don't know, I'm just super impressed. He said that he tested mostly on Magic Online, and I think this is just a testament to the power of your ability to just practice and get those reps in on a convenient format like Magic Online.
Yeah, a terrific job by Seth Manfield, 13-1. So why don't we take a look at what he is wielding today here in the top four. It's Standard, it's Abzan Control. Jackie, over to you.
So there are tons of different ways to build Abzan in Standard. And what's interesting about Seth's build, it's playing the more kind of control slanted version. So there's tons of removal, some sweeper mass removal like Languish and Tragic Arrogance, which we had anticipated. And it's cool to kind of see the balance that he has played between those, which he's only playing a couple of each, one Tragic Arrogance, and the small efficient removal spells. Also, you see he's playing Nissa, Vastwood Seer, so his deck has picked up a lot from Origins.
We know that 4 is the maximum of any one card we're allowed, but a lot of newer players are always surprised when they see a tuned, as we call it, constructed deck list that has one-offs. Because it's like, well, surely if you've only got one of something in your deck, you're hardly ever going to see it. And there are plenty of them. There's a Tragic Arrogance, a Tassiga, a Baalblight, a Silence the Believers, an Ultimate Price. How is that right, if you'd like, to have all these one-offs floating around rather than just saying, I want 4 Baalblight because I want to draw them all the time?
Right, so exactly. The removal suite, he's playing a lot of one-offs, and he's playing like 1 Baalblight, 3 Heroes Downfall, 1 Silence the Believers. Well, the thing is, these all do different things. They all have slightly different stipulations on what they can remove and what they cannot remove. And if you draw too many of, say, Ultimate Price, and you find yourself facing, I don't know, Fleece Mane Lions, that's not super helpful. So that's why it's good in these types of decks to diversify your suite of removal.
And is it the case that Abzan Control is a very well-developed list? So it's a kind of archetype that a lot of players are very familiar with, and all the tweaks to it have mostly been made by now. It's a pretty solid list.
Well, it is somewhat flexible. People typically recently have been playing the more aggressive builds like Rietzel is playing, but this slant towards control, which Seth and Owen are on today, you will find that that might be a little bit advantaged against the more aggressive build because as it has larger threats, it's able to go over the top of its slightly more aggressive version.
All right, okay. So
I'm going to make a bold prediction here that Seth Manfield was pretty pleased to go 13-1, but we don't need to predict, we can find out, because he came in this morning to talk with our very own Marshall Sutcliffe.
Here we are on the eve of our first semifinal match. Seth Manfield, welcome to the easy chairs. Are you feeling easy right now? You got to be a little tense.
I mean, yeah, I'm always someone that gets nervous, so I'm a little bit tense, I'm a little bit anxious, but I feel like I've prepared and, you know, relatively speaking, I'm happy, I'm confident, and, you know, going 13-1, you know, will build my confidence a little bit, but
they can never take that one from you.
Yeah.
I mean, what a dominant performance. Looking back at that, you know, what were some of the, like, did you just run hot all day? Were you playing the best Magic you played? Did you feel like, you know, you brought the best decks, you drafted the best decks? Like, did it all just come together? What put together a 13-1 day against that field?
Well, I think when you go 13-1, it's always going to be a combination of both luck and skill. I felt like this was probably the best tournament I played, you know, from up to this point. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's still a lot left to go. But, you know, I feel like the deck choices, I basically ended up getting, you know, good matchups, which was lucky for me. You know, my teammates played the same decks and weren't as fortunate. So just being at the top of the field, I feel like there were different decks at the top versus the bottom. And then, I'm happy with my limited performance and, you know, the
what
decks
was your
I drafted.
Limited performance?
6-0.
So you were pretty happy with that?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Breaking news, Seth Manfield happy with the 6-0. No, that was fantastic, especially across two limited formats that were so different, right? You know, they just don't play out in a similar fashion. So it really showed that, you know, your range when it comes to that. Now, you said you are somebody who tends to get nervous. Are you the type of person that it's the lead up? Like, you just want to get in there and start playing?
Yeah, every time I finish a match, I'm sure people see me. I'm just, like, pacing around the room. I'm just ready. I want to just play, and it's the waiting for sure. Like, it's just the build-up.
But you do sound confident. You had effectively a day off in between when we called the top four and today. You had Saturday. What did you do with your Saturday?
Well, I'm definitely happy that we had a day off because Friday night I just kicked back, I relaxed, I watched the new video, and, you know, on Saturday it was basically mostly testing, I will say that. I basically put my teammates through the grindhouse, I guess. But, you know, I'm happy with where we're at. Obviously, I'm playing in the semifinals. I'm playing a deck that I've never played against before.
Yeah, this is the mono-white deck.
Mono-white devotion from Sam. So, you know, that in itself, you know, was nervous to me, just because it wasn't something I was prepared for.
But you did have enough time there to kind of suss out how the matchup plays out and get a feel for even some of the more subtle interactions.
Yeah, I mean, I feel confident about it now that I've seen how the matchup plays out.
Good. Who helped you out? Who'd you test with?
Well, my teammates, Steve Rubin, Ari Lax, and, of course, Brad Nelson, and then a future teammate for the next Pro Tour, Matt McCullough, is here, too, and we were staying at his house playing games. And, Brad and I were just playing all day. So
you know,
it's
not bad to have Brad Nelson as your testing partner when you're going to be playing standard for the rest of the day, right?
By the end of it, he was toast. He was just like, I can't do this anymore.
You worked him into the ground?
Yeah. So it was great. It was fun. I enjoyed the testing. So.
You didn't mind it at all?
Yeah.
And how far ahead do you go in testing? I mean, it's only the top four here, right? We don't have the top eight where there's all these crazy permutations. You know, if you manage to get by Sam, you know it's going to be this or this in the finals. Did you go ahead and test those as well?
We did. Those are matchups that, first of all, I already played against Paul and Owen in the Swiss rounds.
In the Swiss.
Yeah, and I did well against them. It's also Abzan Control Amir and Abzan Aggro. Both of those matchups, we extensively tested beforehand, so I didn't play as much versus them.
Sure, but these are the matchups that you expected to face, perhaps just in the main part of the tournament. Anyway.
Yes.
Yeah. So, now, when it comes to down the stretch, do you let yourself, you know, kind of view yourself holding a trophy and chatting with us up at the news desk, or is that something that you kind of?
I try not to think about it. Of course, I have, but I try just to think about it as any other match and not to think about God, the stage and everything on the line. I can't.
It's not just
I can't. But I try to.
But at least that's your goal.
Yes.
That's fair. Yeah, I totally get it because, like, I think that, like, the true gamer approach is what you're aspiring to, but yeah. You're also a human, it turns out.
Yeah.
And it's just so difficult to take. And, you know, we've got the lights and there's going to be a big crowd and all that stuff, too. With probably a bunch of them cheering you on. Seth, thanks for taking the time to sit down with us. I know this is tense moments before your first semifinal match. We appreciate you taking the time, and good luck in your match.
All right, thanks, Marshall.
All right, so that's Seth Manfield. And, you know, we've seen players go on a run like this before at the World Championship, only to run into a Yuya Watanabe in the finals. So there'd be two players who could potentially play Watanabe to Seth Manfield's Yasuoka. The first of those is Sam Black. So let's take a look at the person who would be the Slayer of Kings here. let's take a look at Sam Black's profile. There you get a look at him. Platinum Pro, 312 lifetime pro points. That's pretty amazing. He of course, has won the Team World Championship. Came in third at Pro Tour Theros playing a Devotion deck, not quite the Devotion deck we're going to be talking about in a few minutes.
No, but he's practiced at tapping Nykthos, doing the Nykthos math.
Two Pro Tour top eights, and of course now this, the World Championship. Let's take a look at how he did in the four formats here. So not a great Modern Masters draft for Sam, and also not a great Origins draft for Sam. I think that's kind of interesting.
Yeah, and we're going to see that as we look at the round by round. But Sam went 2-4 unlimited in this tournament, and it went 7-1 in constructed.
Well, that bodes well for him here since, you know, there's going to be no drafting here in the semifinals. Yeah, let's take a look at his round by round. And Luis, if you could talk us through some of the things that stand out to you here.
Again, I think the most interesting part is the 3-1 in Modern, thanks to partially Gear Per Aether Grid, even though we did see Tiago shut him down with a needle in those rounds. But the 4-0 in Standard to tail off the tournament. And that's especially good because, well, all the rounds left are Standard. So being undefeated with your Standard deck going into the finals is a pretty good sign.
And he did beat Owen in the finals playing an Abzan deck. So, you know, that's all that's left here. Abzan decks.
That is basically the same matchup he's facing in Seth. So the fact that Sam's able to beat him in the Swiss is a good sign, even if Sam is not the most confident going in. At least that's what he's running.
Let's take a look at that deck list. Let's show you what it is. He's playing Mono White Devotion. And Luis, walk us through how this deck works and what its game plan is.
This deck is quite mid-rangey. So it's not exactly trying to go over the top like, for example, the Mono Green Devotion deck. It is trying to use the power of Nykthos to, you know, cast Elspeths and Wingmate Rocks and activate Mastery of the Unseen. Mastery is one of the most important cards to the deck. But it also, you see, as cards like Soldier of the Pantheon, Knight of the White Orchid, Anafenza, it's looking to attack its opponent and pressure them early. I saw him defeat Paulo Vitor Domodorosa playing Esper, mainly because he was able to pressure Paulo's life total so much that even though Paulo was getting 2-for-1s off Languish and casting dragons, Sam was able to squeak out those last points of damage with Mastery of the Unseen and the small creatures.
Okay. Well, you know what? We had a chance to talk to Sam before the tournament. Let's hear what he had to say about playing in the World Championships on Sunday.
Hello. They're sitting at the easy chairs here on the eve of the semifinal match with Sam Black. Sam, welcome.
Hey.
You had a day and a half after the top four announcement. What have you been up to?
Let's see, there was the Enter the Battlefield preview last night, or 2 nights ago. That was great. And then yesterday, I went for a walk with Lex, and then tested the matchup a bit with Patrick Chapin. And then got some food, came to the Battle for Zendikar preview party thing here. I think that I have the easier side of the matchup in terms of preparation. All of Seth's, like, Seth has almost 75 cards that are good against me.
Oh, no.
And so he has to figure out what combination of those he wants in his deck, whereas I have a lot of cards that are not good against him, and I will not put them in my deck. And also, just, you know, when you're preparing, like, Abzan is something that everyone's going to play against. Mono White, not necessarily something he's going to play against. So I think that it's disadvantageous for me that we had all this time for him to get caught up and figure everything out. But I don't know, I felt like I basically got enough work to solidify my plans and situation.
How do you feel about it? I'm getting the vibe that you're not super excited about how the matchup plays out.
I mean, I'm excited to play in the top four of Worlds.
Of course.
I feel like, you know, winning isn't inconceivable. I've played matchups that were, you know, about this bad in the top eight of Pro Tours before and come close. So, you know, I can imagine winning. I don't expect to, but I guess that means I'm winning the expectations game already.
Yeah, you're ahead. Now, I want you to take us a little bit further back in time here when we actually announced the top four. You had a pretty good sweat there.
Yeah. I mean, I was pretty confident that I would make it. I was up like a percent or two, and he was paired down, and I was not. So things would really need to go pretty weird for me to not make it, but there's a huge difference between probably in and definitely in.
Yeah.
It's a really big difference. So it was certainly exciting to find out that I made it. And I mean, I had a bunch of bad matchups waiting for me, but it's still just great to be here.
Yeah, you know, it was really great to see your reaction to it, too. You know, we could tell you were just elated to come up big high fives when you jumped up on the stage and stuff. And, you know, we don't always get to see that side of you. You're pretty reserved, pretty chill, but it was awesome to see you really kind of burst out there. You've been enjoying yourself here
always.
At PAX? Has it been fun?
I mean, I have had fun here at PAX. I have not, like, really interacted with the convention. I don't really do a lot of video gaming, so like
you tend to focus on one game.
Yeah, I tried like going across the street and just like seeing what was up. There was like this big room where they had like darkness and a bunch of people staring at glowy things, and I was like,
"This is not very accurate, by the way, if you've ever been to PAX."
Like, I don't. This is like a bunch of like destination locations. It's not set up for people who just want to like wander around and get a taste. It's for people who like know what they're into to like go to the booth of the like company that they're fans of and like start join a like yelling crowd that's into whatever it is they're doing. And it's just someone walking by. It's all dark and you don't know what any of this stuff is. This it's just, like. This is not the place for me, and then I left.
So I'm a lot like Sam, and this is the most perfect description of PAX I've ever heard, that whenever I go there, I feel exactly the same way.
There are, like, a bunch of people yelling about I don't know what.
Yeah, but of course, for the people that are into it, they're into it. Yeah, we're over here in the magic side, and there's yelling that we
understand. I'm sure that it's exactly the same if they walk over here, but I'm in the right building right now.
Exactly. Now, I did want to go back even a little further in time, looking to the Swiss portion of the tournament of the World Championship. And, you know, this is a tournament unlike most that you play, Pro Tours and Grand Prix, right, where your record...
Yeah, you can lose a lot in this tournament, like a lot. Like, you can just keep losing, and apparently it doesn't matter.
Yeah, the records tend to converge in the middle,
and
they did that here. Is it weird for you playing, you know, where, like, let's say you pick up your third loss, and, you know, in a lot of major tournaments, you'd be like, well... We had a good run.
When I 1-2'd my second limited format, I really didn't think there was a shot that I was going to top four this event.
But then you can like somehow put together a run and get in there. But you knew, right? I mean, you knew at the time, like keep your head down, keep playing matches, that you had a shot still.
Kind of. Like, I mean, you know, like after the like limited portion ended, I legitimately thought that I was just out, but like there's still so much to play for. I mean, every match is a pro point is huge. There's still a reasonable amount of money for top eight. Like, I figured, you know, if I went out, I'd finish like fifth or sixth or something, but Seth just didn't stop losing, and it like pushed down the record that everyone else needs so much to have him just sucking up all the wins. And I mean, like, I needed him to win his last match for me to have a shot. Like, I didn't know that he was going to just keep winning.
Yeah.
It worked out great for me that he did, but I certainly didn't plan for that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I thought that I was, like, I thought I was out for sure for a round or two, and then I was told there was a small chance, and I was like, okay, well, that's nice. I mean, it's probably not going to happen, but okay.
Well, you said you had a small chance there, and you got there. You feel like you've got... A small chance here.
You know, maybe again.
All right. Well, good luck, Sam.
Thank you.
Your semifinal match approaches. We'll sign off here from the easy chairs.
Thanks, Marshall, and thanks to Sam Black. Thanks to Seth Manfield as well. I'm sure when you're playing for the top four of Worlds, you don't necessarily want to come and bare your soul in front of everyone, but we really appreciate them taking the time to do that. I can tell you that we at the news desk have been under attack by small flying things. No, it was not small.
It was an Eldrazi flying thing.
So it wasn't a mist intruder.
No.
Okay. So maybe we need some advice from Paul Rietz on how to deal with that. He is in the second semi-final, but right now it is time for semi-final one. BDM, give me a winner, Seth or Sam?
You know what? I'm going to go against the conventional wisdom here. I'm going to go with Sam. I think that he found a way to beat Owen in that last round of the Swiss, and I think with the backing of Team Ultra Pro, he's going to find a way to do it here in the semi-finals.
Luis, Seth or Sam?
Seth.
Jackie?
Seth.
We don't need to guess, we can find out. Let's take it down. It's time for semi-final one of the World Championship 2015.
Thank you so much, Rich. We are super excited and honored to bring you coverage of the World Championship, the first semi-final. Randy Buehler, Ian Duke, and me, Marshall Sutcliffe. Let's head down to the feature match area right now. Hello and welcome to coverage of the Magic the Gathering World Championship. We're at PAX in Seattle. Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Randy Buehler and Ian Duke. Let's meet our players.
Seth Manfield, United States, top pro points at large.
Sam Black, United States of America, top pro points, North America.
All right, gentlemen, it has been a long road for these players. They had to play, you know, 22 of the other best players in the world to get here. And they finally get to sit down and play Magic, let those nerves dissipate, and start focusing on the game. Let's talk about the matchup. Randy, what are we looking at here?
Seth Manfield's got a whole bunch of cards that are pretty good against Sam Black. The tricky bit is going to be figuring out, especially after sideboarding, which cards he actually wants to line up with. And the tricky part in game one may actually be he's got to make sure he finds lands. He's kept a two-lander with two languishes. So as long as he finds his lands, he's going to be pretty well set up for this first game. He just needs to keep killing everything Sam puts into play. It's the short version of the matchup from his side.
And how do you see it from the other side, Ian?
Well, we mentioned this being a really challenging matchup for Sam Black, and one of the main reasons for that is Sam's early threats, cards like Soldier of the Pantheon and Knight of the White Orchid, really pale in comparison to, or match up poorly against, I should say, against Corsair of Kruphix and Siege Rhino and things like that. So he's got to find a way to really just go wide and overwhelm Seth.
Okay.
He's not going to get the job done with an early rush with weenie creatures.
All right, so here we are. We are underway in our semifinal match, and a good start for Sam Black. He's got a Soldier of the Pantheon, one of the one drops he runs in this deck
to start things off. It's a much better start if he's on the play. Of course, Seth, he earned it. He earned the right to go first in this game with that 13-1 mark.
That's right. Of course, he came in as the number one seed by a large margin, and he's going to kick things off on his side of the table with a Thoughtseize. Now we see one of the kind of headliners for this mono-white devotion deck. We see an Archangel of Tithes right there on top of the library. Randy, what role is that going to play, do you think, in this matchup?
Well, I mean, it's good at having a lot of devotion pips. It's good against decks with a bunch of creatures. It's not at its best in this matchup. 3-5 does mean that it can survive a Languish. That's the nice part of this card in this matchup, which is why I think Seth may look there with this Thoughtseize, just because everything else dies to Languish.
Yeah, I think normally Archangel of Tithes is a little bit of a liability in this matchup because it is pretty expensive and it's a single creature that can be answered with a single removal spell. That said, as Randy pointed out, Seth doesn't have any single target removal spells right now. All he has is the Languish, and Archangel does survive that.
And it looks like Seth is going to play a Scryland and keep the card on top.
It's probably a land, then.
Probably a land, right? And here's Sam Black hitting the red zone, dropping Seth Manfield down to 16, and his only follow-up play on turn two, at least so far, is just another Soldier of the Pantheon. And here is a Nissa now for Seth Manfield.
Yeah, third land showed up just in time to find the fourth one.
Yeah, note also that Seth is pretty stuck on green mana until fetching up the forest here, so he actually didn't have the option to play Corsair of Kruphix that turn. Of course, we know Sam does have a Valorous stance waiting for Courser of Crucifix if that does come down.
Yeah, this works out quite beautifully for Manfield because he gets to dodge Valorous stance and he's going to get a chance to actually hit a land off the top of his library next turn and actually play it.
Well, he does need to play the forest to play the Courser first.
Oh,
he only has single green right now.
Yeah. Sorry, thank
Otherwise,
you.
Otherwise, we may have seen Courser come down that turn.
My apologies.
And he might save the Courser for post-Languish.
Is he going to? He's going to trade off Nissa
here.
He's
going to need to sweep the board before he can flip Nissa, so he may as well just trade it for Soldier, see if Sam will commit something else to the board.
Which this kind of... Ooh, he did commit something else to the board, though.
Indeed.
It doesn't die to Languish. Master of the Unseen, one of the key cards here, Randy.
Yeah, that's got to be Sam's best card in this matchup. It seems there's so much removal in the Abzan deck. It's so hard for Sam to win with that initial rush. Like, maybe when he's on the play, he can get that tempo win, but... Realistically, he's got to go wide with Mastery. That is a hard-to-remove threat, especially in Game 1.
Ian, how hard is Master of the Unseen to remove? If you're sitting in Seth Manfield's seat, does he have ways to kill?
I don't think he has them Game 1. I mean, Game 2, he can bring in cards like Glare of Heresy or even Unravel the Aether to deal with it. But I don't see many good ways in Game 1.
Thoughtseize was his best path.
That's right.
And he used the Thoughtseize. There was no Master of the Unseen when the Thoughtseize resolved. That was what he was looking for. Sam had it hiding right on top of his deck where he wanted it.
Meanwhile, Sam Black continues to chip away with that one remaining Soldier of the Pantheon, dropping Manfield down to 12. Sam does nothing, does not play a land, and just passes the turn back. And there's that Courser of Crucifix. He's going to hit a land here.
Really nice to hit that land
for
Seth Manfield. He does have Elspeth, Sun's Champion, in his hand, so any little bit that works him toward ramping up to 6 mana is huge. And we do see Sam has the Valorous Stance here, so getting value off that Courser before it's answered by Valorous Stance, really, really good thing for Seth Manfield.
All right, so Soldier of the Pantheon again hits the red zone. That's going to drop Seth down to 11.
So it is technically possible for Seth to remove that Mastery in Game 1, but it requires... Tragic Arrogance and a Banishing Light as the one enchantment that Sam gets to keep.
You found it, Randy. Well done. All right, so pretty tough sell there for Manfield to actually get rid of Mastery. Now, he does
Elspeth
have ways to mitigate what it does, though, right? We talked about Languish.
Yeah, two copies of Languish in his hand to sort of sweep things away, but he's got to figure out how's he actually going to win eventually. Like, he can keep it in check for a little while. I think Elspeth is the real plan here.
Well, how about Elspeth then?
Yeah.
Here's Elspeth for Seth Manfield, a huge play for him as Sam Black, missing multiple land drops here, doesn't even have enough mana to make one Master of the Unseen token the fairway.
Yeah.
And is falling behind woefully here. He does find a card he can cast with Brimaz, but that's not the first order of business. It's Banishing Light to take care of Elspeth, and that just leaves the Soldier tokens behind, but those are going to hold back the Soldier of the Pantheon quite nicely here. This is a couple of big turn sequences here for Game 1.
That Banishing Light proving really key here. As we talked about, Seth doesn't have good ways of removing enchantments, at least in Game 1. And Elspeth is one of the few ways to really shore up the ground permanently against a Master of the Unseen.
Yeah, I thought this was a game where Seth was going to need struggle for his land drops, though, when I looked at the opening hands, and it's Sam who's only found a one plains the entire game.
Yeah, he's the one who's supposed to have great mana here, right?
Like, mm-hmm. 21 basic lands. Your mana's supposed to work.
Now, the other card I'm really excited about in Sam's hand right now is Wingmate Rock. I think that's a key card in this matchup. Abzan, I mean, can't block flyers, and it takes two removal spells to beat a rated Wingmate Rock. So if Sam can get up to 5 mana, that card's going to do a lot of good work for him.
If. Yeah, I get excited about that card 2 land drops from now.
All right, well, all 3 soldiers are going to hit the red zone. First blood for Seth Manfield. Sam Black falls down to 17 life. But he's got a Siege Rhino. Sam Black immediately triggers his Soldier of the Pantheon. He's going to gain a life off of that to help offset that a little bit. But it's still a massive Siege Rhino. And when you look at Sam's board, he's got a 2-1. Like, that's his whole board state right now.
And for those who may not be sure at home, Soldier of the Pantheon does have protection from multicolor, but Siege Rhino does still trample over it for 3 damage.
Yeah, good clarification there, Ian. So, second copy of Banishing Light eats up the Siege Rhino. That clears the way for the Soldier to get in there and drop Manfield down to 12. But no land drop here for Sam Black. He just cannot find a way to get these cards in his hand out, or even just start dumping mana into Mastery of the Unseen. That land drop is just killing him here. A couple of soldiers are going to bash. No blockers available for Sam Black, and Seth just passes a turn. No play there.
There's land number four.
Okay, so land number four has now arrived for Sam. Sam has that Wingmate Rock in hand that you mentioned, Ian. He's also got a Brimaz, but it looks like he's just going to pass a turn.
Yeah, I like the play here. I mean, Sam hasn't really presented a threat that warrants a single target removal spell like Hero's Downfall or Abzan Charm yet. So he's got to figure that Seth is sitting on at least one easy way to answer Brimaz.
And this way he can mitigate that by using Master of the Unseen instead. All right, let's see what Seth found. He did nothing that turn. Like you said, Ian, the fact that he's got four cards in his hand and just did nothing for the turn means that those are likely spells, but they're not sorcery speed, threats, or creatures, so that means they're probably removal spells. Ugh, here's a Den Protector, though, for Seth Manfield. He is going to cast it, immediately turn it over, and get back his Nissa, and he's going to play Nissa as well. Go find himself a forest. There it is. Jeez, all it takes is one Den Protector, right? And all of a sudden, your fortunes flip pretty violently in your direction. He's going to play the forest. You can see Seth is, it's pretty intense when he plays. And there's the forest, and that is going to flip Nissa. So Nissa transforms into Nissa Sage Animist, which is going to, let's see what Seth wants to do, start drawing him some cards. So he's going to plus Nissa. And speaking of drawing more cards, there's an Abzan Charm.
This is a rough spot for Sam. He's already used two of his three Banishing Lights. His only other really good way of dealing with Nissa, Sage Animist, is a flyer. So, I mean,
so maybe he needs a land here?
Yeah,
he
land
did.
Here
he found
is a
plains.
Good start.
So this actually can get his Wingmate Rock going. He can attack with something. There it is. It's just going to be the Manifest. So Manfield will now know what's happening here. But he can't do much about it. The question is, how much spot removal does Manfield actually have in his hand?
He does have the Abzan Charm we just saw off of Nissa and a Hero's Downfall he's been sitting on. Okay. Or he has the option to just sweep the board with Languish.
Not a bad option here, right?
Right.
I mean, the Den Protector isn't going to be able to attack through the Wingmate Rocks anyway.
Yeah, I mean, he either throws removal spells at both halves of the Wingmate Rock, or he languishes.
Yeah. It looks like you just languish, and I mean, you're the one with the Planeswalker. Sam Black stuck on mana for much of this game. Seems to have drawn himself out of it now, but very well could be too late for him.
Yeah, I think I would just languish here. The one argument against it is Sam does already have a Mastery of the Unseen on the battlefield, mm-hmm. So if you think the game is going to go long and that Sam is going to leverage a lot of value out of the Mastery, you may want to hold on to your sweepers. That said, I think
3/2 Den Protector attacking into a pair of 3/4 Wingmate Rocks. I think we know which one Seth decided.
We figured it out. Yeah. I think the problem, Ian, from Seth's side is that if these Wingmate Rocks are going to crunch pretty hard here, he's at 12, so he actually needs to get rid of those. And Sam decides just to take the damage here rather than risk the Abzan Charm that he knows that Seth has in his hand. So here's that Languish. Yeah, I like this from Manfield. Remember, he's the one with Nissa Sage Animist fueling his hand. He's also got an Abzan Charm in his hand to draw cards. Oh, and boom, down. Making a Shia token. And a Siege Rhino follow-up. Wow, Seth Manfield firing on all cylinders here. Jeez. And, we've seen this since its time in Standard, Master of the Unseen. If you can activate it once per turn, it's generally pretty unexciting. When you pay 4 mana to make a 2/2 and your opponent pays 4 mana and they make a Siege Rhino, for example, you're going to fall behind pretty quickly. It's when it gets broken with cards like Nykthos that you see that card really shine and turn the corner and even not care if your opponent's playing cards like Siege Rhino because you're gaining so much life and affecting the board in such a meaningful way.
Yeah.
Just look slow here.
The other place it can shine is if the game goes super long and turns into an attrition battle where each player is one for one-ing with each other. Sam's presenting a big threat. Seth is answering it with the hero's downfall. So I think we talked about this a little bit before the match, and Randy mentioned post-sideboard, I think we're going to see Seth really move away from that one-for-one plan because it is so weak against a late-game Master of the Unseen and move more into like playing lots of board sweepers and kind of trying to lock out the game.
That makes a lot of sense. All right, well, Sam has Knight of the White Orchid. It's going to get him a Plains. But he's just going to pass a turn back now with that Master of the Unseen activation available. But his life total is dwindling quickly here. He's down to 7. Seth Manfield is going to clear the way here, it looks like, with the Thoughtseize. He sees another copy of Master of the Unseen and then the two Brimaz that we know about. So this leaves Sam Black as his only option is to make a manifest here. It would also tap him out to do so. Now, the Abzan Charm, of course, in Seth Manfield's hand cannot kill either of the creatures, so he can't go for lethal here, even though he does have a Hero's Downfall as well as the Abzan Charm. He could go for Abzan Charm on Siege Rhino. That would be for 6, which would leave Sam Black at 1, which is virtually the same as putting him to 3, so he's just going to say, yeah, sure. Sam makes the obligatory chump block and drops the 3 life.
This matchup looks every bit as bad as Sam seemed to say it was.
I have to agree with you, Randy. I when we chatted with these guys on the easy chairs before the match, you saw it. They both kind of were on the same page. And
did Seth just put a second copy of a legend in the play, or is it minus 3? -3, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Seth tried to go minus, which fails for 2 different reasons, right?
It is -2.
It's -2.
But I think now he's realizing that it is a legend. He may not have realized that.
Yeah.
When Sam said it's a
going
legend.
To make the motion.
Yeah, and I think Sam's holding him to it here. I'm not really sure what the.
I mean, he activated it.
Yeah, right? No, I know. It seems reasonable. Let's listen to him.
I don't know. Can we? So I mean, what's the final ruling on that? Okay.
Yeah. So it's in the gray area of at what point have you officially activated your Planeswalker? And I think the contention from Sam is well, he moved his dice off of it, which was enough for me.
Yeah, he put it in the graveyard.
Yeah, put it in the graveyard. So
wow,
he's going to give us a Shy of Vigilance for the turn, but that token is a legend. You can't have 2 of them on there. So. A misstep there from Seth Manfield, but it does look like he's far enough ahead that it won't punish him here.
Was that a Banishing Light that Sam just picked up?
Archangel.
Oh, Archangel, I see. Okay.
Yeah, I saw him put it from the graveyard back into play. I thought it was pretty clear that he'd activated it. Just like, oh,
yeah.
Isn't it -2?
Yeah,
-3?
I think that's true. Yeah, and I think that's what Sam was saying, too.
Yeah. So that'll do it for game one.
Yeah, that will do it for game one. Seth Manfield, in a pretty dominant game one, really defeats Sam Black to take the first of this best of 5. We will be back right after these messages.
Join the battle with the new mechanics like Rally and Converge to help the people of Zendikar rise up against the alien threat of the Eldrazi. See more amazing previews of Battle for Zendikar at MagicTheGathering.com. Face a natural disaster in the newest Magic the Gathering set, Battle for Zendikar. Join the battle at pre-release events on September 26th and 27th. Visit locator.wizards.com to find a store near you.
And welcome back to the feature match era here at the World Championship. Now, I'm going to be looking to you two gentlemen to speculate on what's going on sideboarding, but, before I send it to you, I guess we'll just send it right to the players to hear from them.
All right, Seth, potentially as many as 4 sideboarded games coming up. What is your strategy for preparing for those games? What do you take it, bring in, and what do you take out?
Okay, well, some of the cards I'm looking to cut, normally I'm going to be boarding in some removal spells, so I might take out some of the more expensive cards, like Elspeth can be marginal because he's got a lot of flyers, so sometimes he can just attack it and kill it. And then there's some other like removal in the deck, like Bile Blight, that's not that great after board. And with Abzan Control, you're normally just upgrading cards. You're just boarding in cards that in a specific matchup are just like a little bit better than your main deck cards. So like, for instance, Glare of Heresy is like the best possible sideboard card I could think of for this matchup. Obviously, I wasn't thinking about Mono White Devotion when I added Glare of Heresy to my sideboard. It was for the other Abzan matchups, but, you know, it's great. I mean, it's just the best card because it can exile Mastery of the Unseen, Banishing Light, as well as basically all of his creatures, or even his Elspeth if he decides to bring those in. So that's the number one card I'm boarding in. Then I can potentially board in Drown in Sorrows. If I'm on the draw and he's keeping in like his Soldier of the Pantheons, his Kithian, then Drown might help save me from taking a lot of damage. The other card that I'm looking to board in the sideboard is probably Tragic Arrogance. I have one main deck, and it's really good, especially if he's got multiple enchantments in play, or even if he just has a hanger back in play, because my mass removal spells can help me reset the board, even if he goes like a rated Wingmate Rock. He's got four Wingmate Rocks in his deck, and that's one of the big problem cards. So I've got Languishes, and I've got Tragic Arrogances to deal with his Wingmate Rock. I may decide to board in the Ugin as well, because I have a lot of one-ofs in the sideboard. So Ugin the Spirit Dragon, that could be a Planeswalker that might be upgraded for like an Elspeth Sun's Champion in the main deck. And then I have one ultimate prize in the main deck, and then I'm probably going to board in the second ultimate prize from the board because most of his creatures are just mono white, and ultimate prize is one of the best removal spells there.
All right, Seth Manfield, good games the rest of the way in the semifinals.
Thank you.
All right, Sam, when you built your sideboard, you knew you might be playing as many as four games with it after game one. What's the plan for this matchup?
Well, the plan for this matchup is to be a little bit flexible. Seth has a lot of cards that like are somewhere between very good and somewhat good or situationally good against me. He has just a bunch of options. And so what I want to do is going to depend slightly on which direction he chooses to take his deck. So I'm going to start with my best guess of where he's going to go, but I'm going to try to remain flexible about exactly which cards I end up having based on which cards I see from him. With the long series like this with so many games, there's a lot of room to shift back and forth. I know that I get to bring in Valorous Dance, which is my best removal spell in the matchup because it kills most of his relevant things and can protect my guys. And I get to bring in Elspeth, which is just a good additional threat to kind of diversify the ways that I'm attacking. And his deck is good enough at slowing a game down that we're going to get to the point where I have six mana basically every game. Outside of that, like, it's just going to depend on exactly what cards I see from him.
Okay. Sam Black, good games the rest of the way in the semifinals.
Thank you.
And welcome back. Ian, one of the cards that jumped out to me there was Ugin.
Yeah.
You know, that last board state we saw, a Master of the Unseen and a pair of Banishing Lights sitting on the battlefield. And, you know, getting rid of those in one sweep seems like it would be pretty huge.
Yeah, we heard Sam say that the game is going to go long almost every time. We talked about how Master of the Unseen is one of his best cards in the matchup when the game does go long. Ugin is a great way for Seth to just come back from basically any board state there. Also, really important, Ugin removes any Banishing Lights that may have come down earlier in the game, so it can really just turn around a board state very, very quickly. That said, we heard from Seth that he was considering taking out his Elspeths because maybe they're a bit too slow. So it's not clear to me whether Seth is going to want to go all the way up to Ugin. One other important thing about Ugin is that the Manifest for Mastery of the Unseen don't get removed.
That's
from
right.
Ugin's minus because they are colorless creatures.
I was a little surprised to hear Seth, I may do this, I may do that. I was expecting a little more like, okay, well, here's where I'm going to start. You know, maybe I'll customize it. But I don't know if he hadn't made up his mind or was just being a little sort of cautious and committing to a plan that he knew that he might change. I talked to Pat Chapin last night, actually, at the big Battle for Zendikar party. And Pat was helping out both his Ultra Pro teammates, both Sam and also Paul Rietzel, who we'll see in the next match. And, you know, it was Pat who was actually in the role of Seth Manfield. testing against Sam Black. Mm-hmm. And it started out, you know, Sam was winning his fair share. He was winning, you know, maybe half the games. And Pat then started sort of figuring out how to customize the sideboard. And Pat's take on the matchup was that Seth's best plan is to make sure Sam can't go wide. Right, it's maximize the sweepers and have the big expensive threats. Like Pat seemed to think Ugin was one of the best cards in the matchup. Actually, sure, it doesn't kill the manifests, but you're gonna have all of your drowns and your languages to kill those. You just need to be able to make sure you kill those enchantments, kill a Master of the Unseen in particular. It's pretty interesting how much these sideboards actually customize against each other. The card that Patrick wound up cutting from Seth's deck a little bit is he was actually shaving on Siege Rhinos.
What?
He was shaving Siege Rhinos, yeah.
Wow.
And he also felt like Ultimate Price, the way Sam was sideboarding, Ultimate Price might not be the best card.
Get some got some looks from the crowd when you said that, Randy. People are offended at Siege Rhino.
Look, Patrick Chafin said this is how he was sideboarding, and he started crushing Sam like it's toward the end of their session.
All right. Well, we're underway here in game two. Sam Black, no one drop this time. Seth Manfield with a temple to start things off and put the card back on top. So he likes what he sees. And there's a Master of the Unseen. Sam Black is going to get that out of his hand before Seth has the ability to cast a Thoughtseize on Sam here. So he's basically just protecting that. Sure, it's not a potent threat at this stage of the game, but he wants to make sure that he doesn't get Thoughtseize. So down it goes. Passes the turn back to Manfield, who right away here on turn two sees, you know, probably the most problematic card in the matchup for him, staring him down, and he's going to have to craft a game plan around beating that.
So a couple interesting things looking at Seth's hand. One is he's a little stuck on land here, it looks like.
He found it.
Oh, he did find it. Okay. So that third land is huge because that lets him then play Nissa, Vastwood Seer.
Yeah.
And guarantee his fourth land drop as well.
He's actually got a Windswept Teeth in his hand
as well. Oh, he does. Okay.
Yeah. He kept two again, and then found the lands he needed.
Yeah, I think he put one land on top with the Scry land, and it's just kind of moving things forward. Nissa, really nice for keeping those land drops flowing as well. We've seen that be an important role here in an Abzan control deck. You know, she's not, doesn't have quite enough punch for the more slimmed down versions usually, but here in the control world, she's a welcome addition to the deck.
Yeah, huge addition for sure. The other interesting thing here is Seth mentioned he may be taking out or trimming Elspeth's, but he does have one in his hand here, so it looks like he decided to go that route.
And Seth confidently passing the turn back to Sam Black, who is going to use Knight of the White Orchid to get him an extra land for free. It can go get a Plains, it puts it on the battlefield.
And interestingly, Sam actually skipped playing his third land on turn three. This is something he talked about on Friday in the Swiss that he sometimes does with Knight of the White Orchid just to get extra value out of it. And that value, getting the extra land, is going to be important if the game does go long. Especially since he has Master of the Unseen. Mana source counts.
Yeah, and you know, he still had his land drop to play this turn. He does so, and he even plays a Hangerback Walker on one counter.
Yeah, he gets the 4 mana on turn 4 either way. It's just this way there's one less land in his library. One more in his hand.
One more in his hand, that's right. So Sam's going to pass the turn back. A nice turn for Sam Black. And there's a Courser of Crucifix, and Seth does hit a land off of it. Temple of Silence is going to get him a scry here. And he sees an Ultimate Price on top of his library.
Yeah, this is a card that, like I said, when Patrick Chapin was playing this matchup against Sam, he wound up falling out of love with. It looks like just the perfect removal spell against his deck with like Archangel of Tithe and Brimaz. But those are some of the cards that Sam sideboards out a little. So if there aren't as many of the big white creatures in Sam's deck, then you know, you can't Ultimate Price a Hangerback Walker.
I see that Sam has a Wingmate Rock in his hand. It also speaks to that point.
Right, right. It makes two creatures, where again, Ultimate Price doesn't line up nearly as well as
Language.
Sweeper effects.
Yeah, exactly.
So Sam has two options this turn. One is to attack with one of his creatures, sort of suicide attack with it, and play the Wingmate Rock. to trigger a raid. The other is just to keep ticking up his hangar back walker and making manifests with Master the Unseen. So this is a real turning point that's going to tell us whether Sam wants to play aggressively and just go for the flyers and start attacking with them, or if he wants to play a more cautious, longer game.
Yeah, it's interesting. He kind of exposed himself a little bit to language with the, you know, the 1-1 hangar back plus the knight. Seth then added a 2-4 creature to his battlefield. So if I'm Sam, I don't think Seth has a language. Like, Seth wouldn't have played a courser if he had a language in his hand, I don't think. Which means that Sam can aggressively go for Wingmate Rock without as much fear of that sweeper.
Looks like a double block here for Seth Manfield.
Just wanted to make sure nothing went wrong.
Hangerback Walker hits the bin, leaving him with a flyer and a rated Wingmate Rock. This would be a great time for a Languish. There's a Siege Rhino on top. Wingmate Rock applies a lot of pressure. Yeah, Seth Manfield wouldn't mind keeping his Courser of Crucifix around or maybe even hanging around for Nissa, but that's a ways off. He's actually going to crack a Windswept Teeth here as well.
He wants to shuffle Arrogance away. Here.
Okay,
He doesn't have a language in his hand. The one sweeper that he does have is Tragic Arrogance.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense because there was a Siege Rhino on top of his library, and they don't shuffle those away lightly.
Oh, wow, we got the actual sideboarding.
So what happened?
Seth took out all his Thought Seizes. -4 Thought Seizes, took out an Elspeth, a Bile Blight, and a Hero's Downfall. Put in Ugin, Dromica's Command, 2 Glare of Heresy, excuse me, Tragic Arrogance, Ultimate Price, and Unravel the Aether. Yeah, so Thought Seizes is the card. He figures if we're going to be trading removal spells for creatures, the game's going to go long. You're not going to have a lot in your hand.
And he's just going to have to answer any Master of the Unseens, as
yeah,
he said.
Yeah, he did not bring in Drown in Sorrow. So he's not maxed on sort of sweeper effects.
But all right, here it is, Tragic Arrogance. And he gets to pick the Courser of Crucifix as an enchantment here. That's going to leave Sam Black with a Thopter.
Wow.
Conversely, he gets to pick the artifact you can keep his Thopter, the creature you can keep his Thopter.
Oh, man. And he actually attacks for 4 damage that turn. That was a big tempo swing. Now, the good news for Sam Black is that he does still have Master of the Unseen. The bad news for him is that Siege Rhino he shuffled away, it's back. Always looming. A second Master of the Unseen for Sam Black. Now, the second one doesn't let you make more manifest, but you do gain more life when you turn him up.
Yeah.
Oh, geez. And now Dromica's Command on top of the library, too? Oh, one of them's going to go away.
I mean, Sam did get kind of blown out by that Tragic Arrogance, but I got to say, I actually like the way he played that sequence. I think he correctly read Seth for not having a Languish. So, and you know, we could see the top of the card on the library wasn't a Languish either. So he kind of moved in and exposed himself to a sweeper effect. But you know what? When you're the dog in the matchup, you have to kind of take risks like that.
Yeah,
out,
definitely.
Seth
agree
was
with
holding
that.
Tragic Arrogance.
The other nice thing about playing aggressively with Wingmate Rock is it prevents Sam from sticking an Elspeth very well. Which, if Seth didn't have the Tragic Arrogance, that was sort of his next line of play.
And there it is, Elspeth. You just mentioned it, Ian, and Sam's line did prevent it that turn. But now the coast is clear, and Elspeth's Sun's champion and friends have joined. And there's a manifest from Sam Black. I almost got a look at it there. I couldn't quite see what it was, though.
Finishing up that sideboard conversation, by the way, Sam took out Anathenza, Kithian, and 2 Archangels in exchange for 2 Elspeth, a Valorous Dance, and a Vanishing Light.
Sam draws a Soldier of the Pantheon for the turn. Not what you want to see at this stage in the game. Sam's going to line up an attack with the Thopter, take a hit, dropping Elspeth down to 4 loyalty before deciding what he wants to do with the rest of his turn here. It looks like it's going to be Soldier of the Pantheon. He's going to pass the turn back to Seth Manfield, who's at 22 life, drawing Dromica's Command with Siege Rhino in hand. There's an ultimate price for his next draw step.
The only good news is there's no 7th land to flip Nissa.
Yeah. That is the good news. You found the good news. Because the top of Seth Manfield's library has not brought good tidings for Sam Black.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing Sam's trying to accomplish here is, I mean, yeah, he's going to see if these masteries can actually get out of control. Maybe he'll top deck on Nykthos. Maybe he can get on the double mastery plan and flip them the game in enough life to race this Elspeth. But the other thing that he wants to do here is he wants to see as much of Seth's sideboarding plan as possible. He wants to be able to customize his sideboarding plan for game three. So, I mean, sure, he wants to win this game. Probably doesn't fancy his chances, but there's information to be gained, even if he can't manage to take the game win.
It looks like Seth wants to take care of one of these Masteries of the Unseen to start things off here. He's got to pick his other mode. He's going to have his Courser of Krufix fight the Manifest, along with forcing Sam to sacrifice an enchantment.
Not too much of a risk in fighting the Manifest here, because worst case scenario, he flips up a 3-4 like a Wingmate Rock.
Or a Brimaz.
Or a Brimaz or an Archangel, also 3 power. So.
Well, let's see what Sam's actually just going to activate right now. He does have 2 mana available, so before his other mastery is gone, he could gain a bunch of life, and he's going to. There's a Kithian. 1, 2, 3, 4. He gains 8 here? In the meantime, this Dromica's command is still on the stack, waiting to resolve. He gains 8, 23. Yeah, you can see how 2 of these Masteries of the Unseen can get out of control. I like the line that you had lined up there, Randy, where he finds a Nykthos and can start just generating massive advantage, but this is going to make it tough on him as one of them is going to be in the graveyard now. Like Manfield might have his eyes on that Siege Rhino of his. He does indeed. So Siege Rhino hits the battlefield. That's going to trigger Soldier to the Pantheon for Sam Black, but really start to fortify Seth Manfield's board state here as he moves forward with Elspeth making 3 tokens, passing the turn back to Sam Black, who has plenty of mana and a Master of the Unseen, but is starting to fall behind. Now, I do see a Nykthos in hand there for Sam, Randy. So
it doesn't turn a profit yet.
Not yet.
With the Mastery gone, but it is also the 8th land, so it does turn on double Mastery, even if it's not going to go completely nuts.
Yeah, and this actually does spiral out of control if Sith can't do something about it.
Thank goodness for the Thopter chipping away at Elspeth, right? Elspeth Ultimate would win this race.
Absolutely.
Except she's not going to get to Ultimate with that Thopter chipping away.
This is a real game here. Seth Manfield clearly ahead.
Yeah, and now 7th land.
He found the 7th land too? Oh, no. That's not good news for Sam Black. Sam is fighting the good fight here, but Seth Manfield really just with the powerhouse cards here. Now he's got 2 Planeswalkers, 6 Soldiers, a Courser, and a Siege Rhino with another friend on the way. Yeah, this is just a whole lot for Sam Black to try to deal with, and he just doesn't seem to have the tools to do it.
It's pretty interesting, actually, that Sam's brought this deck to the table. I mean, he did 4-0 Standard as well. And it's an underdog by a not insignificant amount against one of the most popular decks in the field, Abzan Control. Actually, you know, I asked Sam about that, and he said he expected more Hangerback Abzan. Mm. He thought that, you know, the Hangerback Abzan would be the more popular than the Control, and he likes his matchup against the aggressive version of Abzan. It's just the Controlist version is, in fact, good against him. Now, he beat Owen in the Swiss, but Owen also discarded the hand size that game.
Yeah, I know that that both Owen and Seth bringing Abzan Control to the table here did have it in mind that Hangerback Abzan could be popular, and they felt like that was a good matchup for them as well.
You can see why there were only the 3 Hangerback Abzan decks. If, you know, both these guys are like, well, everybody else is going to play that up, but I'm ready for them.
Right. So Siege Rhino's going to hit the red zone. It does get blocked by Soldier of the Pantheon, which has protection from multicolored, but the trample does carry over, as you said earlier, Ian, so still gets in for three. And Siege Rhino into hand, and the hits keep coming for Seth Manfield. Now a Den Protector on top of his library as well. It's just an avalanche of raw power here from Manfield's side of the table. Now, just to be clear, Randy, Seth has the green light here to just flood the board with threats, right? There's no way for Sam Black to... He doesn't have a sweeper or something in his board, right?
Doesn't he have a Tragic Arrogance?
He does have two Tragic Arrogance in his board, but it's pretty unrealistic for him to bring them up in these matchups.
Okay.
And he did not.
Yeah. Right, so there's the Siege Rhino. It looks like Manfield has similar thoughts as he... I mean, look at his board.
I mean, one thing Sam does have is access to two copies of Elspeth, Sun's Champion. So Sam has to be a little, or Seth has to be a little bit careful about committing too many four power creatures, maybe. But I think Seth is just so far ahead at this point that he doesn't really need to play scared. He can just go for the throat. Realistically, Sam's best path to win this game is getting the Mastery of the Unseen to go out of control. So if he can manifest like Archangel of Tides and start turning those up and getting more white mana symbols, then eventually Nykthos can start catapulting his mana forward and manifesting even more times. So he needs some kind of, you know, that kind of like non-linear runaway with his mana and his manifests to get back in the game.
He just drew an Archangel of Tides.
Yeah, so you may say see him take a break from manifesting the maximum number of times just to get more white mana symbols onto the battlefield, so his Nykthos is producing more mana.
Yeah, I mean, he did manifest twice on end step. He's got eight lands now. That was last turn, and he just drew Archangel, which gives him that three mana symbols on the battlefield to complement the two that he already had. Thopter pecks away. So is he going to play the Archangel or just pass?
He passes. He also knew that was an ultimate price in Seth's hand from the Courser.
That's right. And, you know, this worked out pretty well for Sam.
True.
Ultimate price is going to take down the Soldier.
I mean... There's also two Den Protectors.
Yeah, this isn't working out super well for him long term. Basically, it's just a matter of time until Seth Manfield decides to start turning everything sideways. He still has a Siege Rhinos ready to go. Sam Black with just the one mastery means that he's not going to gain absurd amounts of life for flipping up creatures.
Up to three Den Protectors now?
Yeah, Seth has no shortage of resources here, so I think as long as he plays carefully and keeps Sam's permanent count, his white mana symbol count, under control, there's really not a great way for Sam to come back into the game. But, as we saw at moments in the Swiss, it's not unheard of to see a player that's in a winning position, you know, make a blunder that opens the door to the losing player getting back in. We saw that in the final Paul Rietzel matchup in the Swiss.
You know, I think Seth was probably just thinking that himself. No blunders. Languish on top of the library for Manfield after he cracks that Windswept Heath. See how he wants to go about this turn. Sam's at 16. Seth is going to play that first Den Protector face down.
Nine soldiers?
He does have nine, and it kind of looks like he wants to attack with them.
I like it.
Boom! Two Siege Rhinos and nine soldiers. Sam has a response. Before blocks, I'll use my Mastery of the Unseen to make a manifest. And he's going to do it again. You can see Sam moving those out of the way so that Seth can track which order they were put onto the battlefield.
So Sam can pick off 5 soldiers, but then he takes 12.
The thing is, if he wants to try to pick off a siege rhino, he really has to quadruple block it.
Oh, yeah, fair.
Just to be safe.
Probably true.
Yeah, this is a lot of damage. It's 17 damage. So it looks like Den Protector is going to get flipped up here. That's going to get back Dromica's command.
Sure. Kill the Mastery and he pick off a Manifest.
Yes. You sack an enchantment. These two creatures fight. So one of the Manifests falls, and that leaves Sam way up against the wall here in game 2. Seth Manfield has been ahead for the duration of this game, and he just really needed to pick out how he wanted to finish it off, and it looks like this is the sequence that he's chosen, and you can see why.
Yeah, he's pretty much got it.
Sam
he's
takes 13 here.
Goes down to 3.
Yeah, no more life gain from the Masteries. I don't see any way for Sam to even survive a turn.
Right. Languish goes into hand for Manfield off of the Nissa activation there. We'll also note that Manfield has a lethal Den Protector that can't currently be blocked as well as a million other attackers. And this is Sam revealing them. So Seth Manfield, 2-0 now, just 1 to go before he could find himself in the finals of the Magic World Championship. He was a bundle of energy when I interviewed him this morning. I asked him if he was nervous, and he said, I always get nervous. He's the type of player that just wants to be in the match playing, and any in-between time, he's just circling the room. Sam Black, a lot more calm, you know? His demeanor is a lot more chill. All right, we'll be back right after these messages.
Enlist the land itself in the battle against the Eldrazi with Zendikar Expeditions. See more amazing previews of Battle for Zendikar at MagicTheGathering.com. Face unnatural disaster in the newest Magic Online set, Battle for Zendikar. Join the battle at pre-release events October 9th through 11th on Magic Online. Visit MTGO.com to download today.
Welcome back to the feature match area here at the World Championship in Seattle. We're at PAX, and we're in our first semifinal match where Seth Manfield is up 2-0 over Sam Black. Talking about sideboarding, Ian, is there anything that surprised you? You know, we did have our floor reporter down there, Tim Willoughby, bring us up a list of what was actually boarded in and out. You're taking a look at it now. Is there anything that jumps out?
So from Sam's perspective, it looks like a pretty standard sort of first guess at the way the matchup's going to play out post-sideboard. As we saw earlier, Sam said he's going to be pretty flexible and probably changing his sideboard game to game. Taking out Archangel Tides makes a lot of sense. Seth has a lot of one-for-one removal. It's hard to invest 4 mana in a creature that can be answered so easily. And we saw Sam bring in the Elspeths, the Valorous Dance, and the Banishing Light, all of which, you know, seem fairly standard and great against Seth's deck. What was interesting from Sam is that he kept in Soldier of the Pantheon, which I wonder if he plans to do that only on the play and then maybe take them out on the draw, just to have the extra chance of winning with, like, a white weenie rush kind of strategy.
Well, he's going to be on the play again.
Yeah, we may never find out.
Yeah, there's a decent chance of that, yeah. And as we can see, we noted that the 4 Thoughtseize came out for Seth. But he beat 2 Master of the Unseen there, and it wasn't really close.
It's a true story.
Yeah, I particularly like Seth's decision to bring in Unravel the Aether. You might not think that bringing in enchantment removal against, like, a white weenie deck or a mono white deck is obvious, but Master of the Unseen, one of the super important cards here, and also Banishing Light. I mean, killing a Banishing Light and getting back a Planeswalker or a Siege Rhino is just an insane amount of value.
Yeah. Now, you know, for people watching at home, neither of those games were particularly close, right? Seth Manfield got ahead, stayed ahead in both of them, hit his land drops, and was able to put himself in a comfortable position with multiple Planeswalkers both games. What does a win look like from Sam Black's perspective that doesn't involve, you know, something like extreme mulligans or you know, missing a lot of land drops for his opponent?
I think there's 2 flavors. One is he gets the beatdown curve, right? He curves 1 drop into 2 drop into 3 drop and catches Seth without a sweeper, where he can actually, you know, Seth is trading 1 removal spell for one creature, but it's like a 3-mana removal spell for a 1 or 2-mana creature, and Sam's able to just keep attacking with 2 creatures a turn. That is possible. It's not super likely, given the amount of removal in Seth's deck, but it is a way that Sam can win this matchup. It's what we saw him do in the Swiss against Owen, in fact. And the other flavor is, going wide, Seth's got the removal spells to keep Sam's actual creatures in check, but, you know, a Mastery gets out of control, or an Elspeth gets out of control, and Seth just doesn't have the card he needs to kind of clean up and sweep away the horde of small creatures. Those are the two flavors of victories that are realistic for Sam.
Yeah, like you said, they're both relatively unlikely. You know, given the answers that Seth Manfield does have in his deck, that is not the thing that's going to happen most often, but you know, I wanted to map it out.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. It's hard to argue against Sam choosing a standard deck that got him a 4-0. You know, they got him from 5-5 coming out of limited into 9-5 into the top four. But yeah, his matchups against the actual, you know, the winner's metagame, the decks that were at the top of the Swiss, is not that great. His metagame read was sort of slightly off. He was expecting more hangerback Abzan than Abzan control.
And bear in mind, in this top four, Sam's lost a little bit of the surprise value of his deck. I mean, he's playing
That's
an unusual deck. Seth said before he's never played against this deck before. But with the break between Friday and Sunday and players having full information about each other's deck lists, Seth was able to, you know, get some reps in against Brad Nelson, I think, and some of his other teammates.
You hear that, Randy?
I was about to ask if you heard the same thing. Yeah, floor reporter Tim Willoughby whispering from the floor.
Seth's going to be on the draw.
Sam's
going
to
be.
Chose to be on the draw.
Yeah, he's also mulliganing here, by the way. Seth with another 2-lander. He's kept it, though.
This is a really interesting decision. It makes sense on a couple levels. First of all, Sam mentioned he feels it's highly unlikely that he's going to win with a white weenie rush strategy. I mean, Seth has, he's got Courser of Crufix, he's got Nissa to trade, he's got Siege Rhino as a brick wall, he's got sweepers like Languish and plenty of one-for-one removal. On the other hand, you know, Sam is fairly well equipped to play a long game. That's the way he's sideboarded here. He also has Knight of the White Orchid in his deck, which is a lot better on the draw than it is on the play.
Sam chooses to draw. Wow.
So we might see a strategy here of Sam focusing a little bit more on his high end. Maybe he's taken out the Soldiers of the Pantheon now.
Maybe he also saw the ultimate price from Seth, which is the best removal spell against the Weenie Rush portion of Sam's deck.
Right.
Saw multiple Siege Rhinos. I don't know. Maybe he also figures this makes Seth's mana a little sketchier. Right? Seth gets one less card to kind of find the 3 colors and the 4 lands that he really needs to operate. 1 land hand for Sam. Does have a soldier. Looks like he's going to keep, and the new mulligan rule scries to the bottom.
He does. All right, so here we go. Game number 3. This could be the decider for Seth Manfield. If he is going to advance to the finals of the Magic World Championship, this game could get him there. Sam Black has a lot of work to do. He has to win 3 games in a row against an unfavorable matchup. The soldier's still in. So the turn 1 soldier there for Sam on the draw.
Yeah, I mean, I saw Sam talking about that in the deck tech that was recorded with him. You know, you've got all these basic lands in your deck. You're going to have 1 mana on the first turn most of the time. You may as well spend it on something. Like, he just doesn't want to have that turn where he has his mana squandered. Yeah, I heard him talking about how the 2 Kithians in this deck. It's not that Kithian is, oh my god, amazing in this deck. It's just, you know, 6 is about the right number of 1-drops if you want to have a good chance of doing something productive on the first turn. And building white mana pips toward Nykthos, of course.
All right, another scry land here for Seth Manfield. He kept a hand with 2 scry lands, and that was it as far as lands went, but he figured he could dig through his library to find the land drops that he needed to hit. All right, in the meantime, it's Master of the Unseen is the follow-up play. So 1-drop and a 2-drop here for Sam Black, though, once again, the 2-drop.
Yep.
Not one that can attack or block here.
And you know what? We did see Seth sort of control 2 copies of Master of the Unseen in the first game. He also drew his only copy of Traumica's Command to do it.
And bought it back and replayed
right.
it again.
Right.
Yeah, totally.
So I have to say, I was a little nervous there when Sam kept a 1-lander after a mulligan, scryed and scryed to the bottom after not seeing a land on top. He did find a 2nd land on turn 1. And he does have a copy of Knight of the White Orchid in his hand. So.
Oh, jeez. There's Glare of Heresy, though, to exile. Master of the Unseen. That's not coming back. Sam gets to keep chipping away with the Soldier of the Pantheon, but he is going to need to come up with something pretty impressive here. And it is. Knight of the White Orchid is going to get that landform.
Yeah, this is fantastic for him. I mean, I think, especially having chosen a draw, he always wants to see Knight of the White Orchid in his opening hand or early in the game. And this will let him get up to four lands this turn and, you know, potentially leave up mana for a Valorous Dance on Seth's follow-up play if he has something like a Siege Rhino or a Courser.
I wonder how much better Sam's chances would have been if they played yesterday.
You know, I think significantly.
That day for Seth to just figure out what the heck is going on with Sam's deck.
Yeah. It's even a hard deck to categorize. Like,
right.
Part white weenie deck, it's part mid-range, it's kind of part control deck, it's also a big mana deck, so yeah.
Yeah, he just went Soldier of the Pantheon into Mastery of the Unseen.
Right.
Like, how do these cards work well
together? It's definitely got a lot of angles going on, and I think that's like Sam's best advantage he can leverage here is that his deck does attack from a lot of different angles.
It has to. It helps with the 4-0 on Friday.
But yeah, how much did that surprise factor help? That is a reasonable question to be sure. All right, let's see what Seth Manfield has here. He's got an Abzan Charm.
Is he just drawing two because he has no more lands?
Yeah, that's what I would assume here.
I actually heard that Seth and Owen tested together a little bit because they have sort of, you know, shared goals. They both need to understand how Abzan control matches up against this deck and against Paul Rietzel's deck.
All right, attack for four, Seth Manfield. You're at 9 life here. Passes a turn back.
Stuck on lands. Doesn't look like he picked up a land this turn.
No,
either.
He drew a Courser, which he can't cast.
Yeah, no double green.
Wow, major stumble here for Manfield.
He does have an ultimate price. We'll see if he fires that off. But yeah, again,
I think he's going to discard if not, right?
Yeah. He can't be happy, though, missing land drops and having to spend a removal spell on a
this.
One drop. And here
Valorous
comes Valorous Dance.
This is getting aggro.
Protecting the Soldier.
Yeah, Sam Black can see the writing on the wall. He knows that he has Seth Manfield up against it here, missing land drops, and he wants to capitalize in a big way. He is. He's already got Seth
here
down
comes
to 5.
Wingmate
and
Rock
there's Wingmate Rock.
No fear of Languish.
This is Languish or
you
bust
have to
here.
Have the Languish, and you have to top deck an untapped land.
Which he doesn't have very many of, though, did he? Doesn't have the Languish in
hand. He doesn't,
have,
he
the
doesn't
have
the
Languish.
I think he drew Sandstep Citadel. I think he drew a tap land.
Yeah. It was a
Windswept
Teeth.
Oh, it was a Windswept
Teeth.
Okay.
But
so
still.
He, yeah, 4 mana. He does not, in fact, have the Languish. So he can do what? He could have done
yeah,
a
Yeah, and Sam Black wins a game here.
Applause from the audience. They want to see Sam. Yeah, they want to see this go to 4 or 5 games even at least.
Yeah, they want to watch more Magic today, don't we all? So get on the board there for Sam Black. He saw the line. He knew he needed to be aggressive. He protected his creatures, and in they went. Tough one there for Manfield. He had 2 Scrylands to find lands and then an Abzan Charm after he found one and just bricked. Couldn't do it.
One of the loudest celebrators in the crowd, actually, Sam's teammate, Paul Rietzel. He's not off somewhere preparing for semifinal. He's up here cheering for Sam, watching on the big screen.
I do see Paul down there. A lot of the pro players and just a lot of Magic fans in general in the crowd. There's also a lot of them standing to the side. I'd be sitting down. You can see the feature match area. We've taken out the other tables here so that it's all focused in on one thing. One of the cards that we saw critical in that last game and has come up a couple of times already is Valorous Dance. It's a really great tool for a mono-white deck like Sam Black's.
Yeah, Sam talked about this being just one of his best cards in the matchup. It's fantastic against Seth's version of the Abzan deck because it takes out Courser of Kruphix and Siege Rhino, 2 of his most efficient cards, at a mana advantage. It only costs 2 mana compared to 3 or 4. And in addition to that, it can also protect Sam's threatening creatures. If he uses that to protect something like, you know, a Wingmate Rock or a Brimaz or an Archangel of Tithe, that's a huge tempo swing. And even as we saw there, just protecting the Soldier for a turn just kept the pressure on and kept Seth's mana tied up.
Such a flexible card. See quite a bit of standard play at this point.
So now, if you're Seth Manfield, Sam just chose to draw and then beat you because you stumbled on lands. Do you choose to draw?
No.
Do you choose play? But that's what Sam wants you to choose.
Yeah, that's okay.
One of them is wrong. Right? They can't both be right to want Sam drawing and Seth playing first.
I mean, it could also be a little bit of a mind game. We saw Sam choose to draw in game two, or choose to play in game two, then choose to draw in game three. I don't think this is Sam reconsidering and changing his mind. I think he came in here with a coherent plan. I think he's adapting to the way he's seen Seth sideboard. And if both players, or one or the other player, or both players decide to change their sideboarding strategy from game to game, that could also affect whether it's correct to play or draw. So there's like a multi-level mind game going on here.
Oh, interestingly. So in game three, we've just gotten the word up here, Sam actually took out two Kithians, three Brimaz, and an Anafenza.
Wow, so he actually retooled his deck pretty significantly there for the third game.
Yeah, he brought in two Glare, the Valorous Stance, the Banishing Light, the two Elspeths. Seth did not alter his sideboarding plan, although I did see both players shuffle sideboard cards into their deck and then pull them out again so that the other guy wouldn't know. Like, Seth did it correctly. He's not going to change anything, but Sam doesn't know that because Seth did, in fact, fiddle with his sideboard cards between games.
Yeah, that's pretty standard operating procedure at this level, right? Shuffle in your whole board, take out everything, but
interesting. So Sam now took out the Brimazes, not the Archangels.
Right. I wonder if keeping an Archangel tie, this is a little bit of a response to how that second game played out, where Seth did go very wide with Elspeth, and he just kept playing out threats and Planeswalkers, and Archangel of Tithes can potentially turn that into a mana war. Not a mana war, a mana war.
Which Seth did... Seth, if true, that's actually Sam, like, he saw an Elspeth. Seth actually sideboarded out an Elspeth. He has less Elspeths after sideboarding than he did for game one. Sam doesn't know that because, I mean, the limited information he had, he lost to Elspeth. It's always tricky, right, trying to figure out what your opponent's sideboard plan is from the, whatever, 20-ish cards you see in the first game.
Right, and just and trying to infer from the limited amount of information of what cards you see in a particular game and trying to extrapolate that to a general sideboarding strategy or overall strategy.
Super curious to see if Seth is going to choose play or draw here.
This is almost like an academic type, you know.
Right, I mean, if he chooses play, he's basically saying, Sam, you were wrong to choose draw last time. Even though it worked.
Well, we actually thought about it.
Yeah.
And you didn't
I mean, you'll note that I chose play once and draw once.
Yeah.
It's super close. Yeah.
They're talking about that. Sam just said, well, I chose play once and draw once. And, and Seth actually said that they put a lot of time into thinking about it. He just told Sam that. So decision time, though.
Basically, I'll choose... Shrug.
Yeah. Yeah, they said it's very close.
Definitely not a matchup that comes down to that.
Yeah. I mean, knights.
Yeah.
Knights is very close.
Did we hear?
Well, I do see Sam looking at his hand first.
Wow, so Seth chose draw.
Unfortunately for Sam, he looked at it for about half a second before mulliganing it, so that's gone.
Both players have now chosen to draw first.
Is this another two-lander here?
He's kept two-landers in, what, three of three games?
Yeah.
It's two for three, having it work out.
Yeah, and he is on the draw. He does have a Scryland. I saw a Temple of Malady there, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, two-land on the draw with a Scryland seems relatively safe.
Yeah.
The rest of the hand is solid.
So he did decide to draw, which is interesting. But they did say they thought it was very close, Randy. So I don't know if you heard Sam, but he said, it's like you choose shrug. That's what he said, which is... Very, very close decision.
And on the one hand, you can say, well, if it's so close that the players, neither player can tell which is correct, then does it really matter who chooses what? I mean, it's probably, you know, 53-47 type of
there's
advantage
the mind
there.
Game piece. But Sam declared a preference. Seth doesn't want to let him have what he wants.
That's right. And, I mean, we're talking about the world championship here. Getting a 3% advantage, I mean, you got to take every chance you can get, every advantage you can get.
Sam Black trying to mount a comeback here. He lost two games where he was significantly behind in them, and Seth Manfield was able to close the door, but he just got one back. He needs to rattle off two in a row if he's going to find himself in the finals of the World Championship. A loss in either of them put Seth Manfield there. The question that we're going to be following here in the early part of this game is, does Seth hit his land drops, right? He's got a two-lander here with, I believe he has multiple Abzan charms in hand. I think he actually has three in his opener. And he needs to hit that third land drop at some point to start getting the card draw
flowing. Three charms, a glare, and a siege rhino.
And in a pair of lands, yeah. One of them being a temple. His deck is built to do that. Plays plenty of land, so it shouldn't be a major issue for him. And in the meantime, we have Sam Black going down to 6 cards.
Yeah, he won game 3 with 6 cards. Easy keep. Lands. Some stuff.
Yeah, unfortunately he does have 2 pairs of wingmate keep. Rocks, but it's an easy keep
it's
for him.
On the expensive side.
Yeah.
I mean, it's better than 5, but...
All right, he has kept. He's scryed to the bottom. No one drop. Plays a land. Passes a turn. Let's see if Seth can hit these land drops. He's going to play a temple. Any cards we see go back on top of his library, we're going to assume are lands.
Looks like his first draw step was also a temple.
It was. It was another Temple of Malady.
So now you could consider keeping it on land?
Yeah, you could. I think if it were a land, you would keep it. If it's like an ultimate prize, maybe?
Languish?
Yeah, Languish.
So he scribed to the top.
He did. He scribed to the top. But it looked like he thought about it a lot. I'm not convinced that it was a land.
Sam goes hanger back.
Let's see what it was.
Not glare.
It was a land.
It was a land. So yeah. He wasn't sure if he wanted yet another land.
Yeah. Yeah, he went from being concerned about it to already getting the greed scale going back to, I'll just put this one on the bottom. He didn't, in fact, do it. All right, Tim Willoughby just brought us the latest sideboard changes. I'll let you guys review that as we look at the early turns here.
So no changes for Seth. He hasn't changed at
so
all.
So Seth has changed his board once and just ran it since.
Yeah, he sideboarded for game 2 and hasn't changed since. Sam took out Abrimaz for a Banishing Light this time.
From where he was. Okay, so small changes on Sam Black's side and no changes for Manfield. And this is a very long scry. That whole discussion we just had was actually just Seth deciding if he wanted to scry to the top or bottom off of that second temple. Ultimately, he's decided bottom. And you see Sam Black is going to use his hangerback walker immediately here. He's going to make sure that it doesn't get hit before it gets the actual counter on it by main phasing it. And he also has a nice follow-up here with Master of the Unseen. So reasonable start for Sam, but it could get ugly for him. His hand right now doesn't look great. He's got a pair of Wingmate Rocks and another Master of the Unseen in hand with no more lands coming. So he's going to have to draw a few lands in a row to kind of turn on that game plan here. Wingmate Rock is a great threat against Seth Manfield. Demanding a sweeper to take care of it as one card or a pair of removal spells. The flying is a big deal. You mentioned earlier, Ian, that Seth Manfield's deck doesn't have any game against flyers.
That's right.
But Sam is full 2 mana away here from being able to cast those.
Yeah, and one thing that's tricky here for Sam is the Hangerback Walker is really the only threat that he has, but if he continues to tick it up, he exposes it to Abzan Charm.
Yep.
Which is a disaster.
Yeah.
I mean, is 2/2 big enough?
Right. That's the problem. Like, I think that threshold is actually going to 3, where it's a nice clock, right? But if you only stick it at 2, it's kind of ignorable, you know.
Yeah, I mean,
Seth can just say, yeah, whatever, I'll take 2 for a while.
Sam has so little going on right now, I think we may see him take the risk, provided he has nothing better to do this turn. We may see him take the risk of continuing to tick up the Hangerback Walker and just saying, I hope you don't have one of your 4 Abzan Charms.
Yeah. So, into the red zone. Good news for Sam Black, though. He did have Glare of Heresy hit his Master of the Unseen, but he did find a land, and he's, of course, got that backup Master that we saw last turn. And like you said, Ian, yeah, no more for the hanger back. It's just going to start attacking.
Yeah, I think he particularly wants to keep the hanger back around because he wants it to trigger Raid for the Wingmate Rock.
That's a great point. Yeah, seeing that 4th land there definitely gives him hope that he'll be able to play a Wingmate Rock pretty soon.
Yeah, if he can go land off the top here, attack with hanger back and slam a Wingmate Rock, he can really force Seth Manfield to have multiple answers or a sweeper.
Looks like Seth has now found a Languish.
Yep.
But he doesn't have a way to... So what he wants to do is he wants to kill the Hangerback with a 1-for-1 and then Languish away the Thopters.
Interestingly, he can wait if it's an instant to do that on Sam Black's turn, which does prevent Sam from being able to get Raid for that turn.
But the fact that Sam has left the Hangerback at 2-2 and seems like he doesn't want to put it in Abzan Charm range makes... Seth say, okay,
there is a land off the top now.
Okay, just what Sam needed.
And Sam immediately attacks with his Hangerback Walker. This, unfortunately, is not going to work out well for Sam. He doesn't have the luxury of playing around a card like Languish here, and he will be punished for it. So here's Wingmate Rock giving him a total of 8 flying power. And you kind of see the two-handed go, and I just hope you don't have a Languish because he doesn't, again, he just doesn't have a chance to really play around it here. And as it turns out, Seth Manfield does have a Languish in his hand, and he's going to set Sam Black back to just the Master of the Unseen here in his bid to make the finals.
Sam does have a second follow-up Wingmate Rock, though, yes?
Yes, he does. It's unfortunately, it won't be rated.
Well, you'd probably take a turn to make a Mastery Token first.
Yeah, that's more like it. But you know how this goes. Every turn that goes by, it's getting, you know, closer and closer. Yeah.
Sam is not happy about that attack. I think he knows exactly what it means. Like, oh, you do have it, don't you?
Yeah, and he's hoping he doesn't, but...
You have to gamble. Take chances like that.
You got to take the chance.
In this matchup, anyway.
Sam's going to double block, but the Languish is going to finish off the entire board of Sam Black. And it's going to be his job now to recreate something. He's found another land. And, yeah, I think we're going to see him just pass. He does. He passes the turn. He can make a manifest with his mastery, attack with it. That gets him an extra Wingmate Rock token that he wouldn't normally have. And it's going to be Nissa here for Seth Manfield, keeping those land drops flowing as well.
Likely into the second courser here that we saw on top last turn.
Yeah, pretty important here for Seth as well. He's stabilized this board at 18 life with 3 Abzan charms in his hand. He can really use those to propel him into the late game to find all the answers and threats that he'll need, where Sam Black is leaning very heavily on Master of the Unseen and not really able to abuse it at this point. Yeah, and there's more action on the top there as the follow-up Courser of Krufix for Seth Manfield. Reveals a land. He'll take it. Another Plains off the top. You know, we were worried about Sam hitting his 5th land drop. Well, he's surpassed that. He's just gone land. So he's going to get another Wingmate Rock down with Raid, and this could be Sam's last chance here to make a huge play. He's out of cards and out of gas. He's just got the Master of the Unseen.
7 lands,
and the Wingmates. This could be Seth Manfield crafting a game plan now to put himself into the finals.
I mean, he doesn't actually have, he just used 2 Abzan Charms to remove the 2 flyers?
Then he has another Abzan Charm to keep the card draw going and a Siege Rhino as a threat. It does put a lot of pressure on Sam.
Yeah, and the Courser can hold off Masteries for a little while.
For a long while.
I mean, the game isn't over yet.
It is not over yet, but Seth should be eyeballing the finish line here and figuring out. I mean, he just has so many more resources in his hand right now. He's got the triple Abzan Charm and a Siege Rhino. He's got to be able to find a way to win from here.
Seth, just thinking carefully before playing a 7th land here. Transforming Nissa is mandatory. So if he wants to play a 7th land and transform Nissa, he's kind of signing up for killing the 2 Wingmate Rocks.
Yeah, good now one. That the writing's on the wall here as far as what Sam actually has access to as far as cards, he's just going to go ahead and say, all right, fine, you got me. Yeah. You'll get a 2-for-1 out of me.
That probably made sense even if it wasn't for the Nissa flip, but the fact that he's going to be flipping Nissa this turn, I think... You just let the Wingmate Rock 2-for-1 you and figure.
Yeah, transform
so
Nissa.
Far ahead.
Yeah, there's an Unravel the Aether, exactly what he needed to see here. Sam Black is going to get, if he draws a land, he'll have 2 manifests and he'll have nothing left after it.
Paul Rietzel has now left the back row of the crowd and made his way toward the feature match area. Writing is on the wall here.
It is. He's going to make an Ishaya token, pass a turn back to Sam, who's drawn 4 lands in a row and finds the 5th. That does give him extra mastery, but Seth Manfield on the brink of making the finals of the World Championship here with his Abzan control deck. He's got Nissa. He's got a Courser. He's got a Ishaya token. He has the answers he needs and the threats as well. He just has to get Sam to 0. It feels like it's just a matter of time here now for Seth Manfield.
This is 14-1.
He is 14-1. He has absolutely dominated this tournament from the very get-go. Only one match loss in the Swiss, putting him far ahead of the rest of the field. And he's coming here against Sam Black, and it looks like he's going to pick up a 3-1 victory here if he can just close out. Tragic Arrogance is the top card. It looks like he's going to go for the Unravel the Aether right now.
Yeah.
That's going to force Sam to use his Master of the Unseen twice in response, which is exactly what he does. Now Mastery's going to get shuffled into the library. Sam, stoic as ever. Seth surveys the scene here, but he knows that it's within reach now. Seth Manfield just dominating this competition from the early get-go. The only thing left to do is finish off Sam Black and move into the finals. And he's going to pass the turn back now to Sam, who needs to find something. He finds a Soldier of the Pantheon, not what the doctor ordered here. Sam Black snuck into the top four at 9-5 on his tiebreakers. He's not even going to bother to play the Soldier. He's just going to pass the turn back. The manifests are not creatures. There's two spells. There's a Glare of Heresy and a Valorous Stance below those manifest overlays. And he's going to draw a couple of cards as Seth Manfield off of this Abzan Charm, including a Tragic Arrogance and, well, another Tragic Arrogance. Not actually what he wants to see here, I don't suspect. There's a Siege Rhino as well on top. He's going to draw the Siege Rhino.
Sure.
Thanks to Nyssa. He's going to attack with a Shia token here. Sam's at 16 life. He can take a hit.
12 to 17.
And he does. He drops down to 12 life. So Seth looks like he's going to use this turn here to set up the win in the next turn or two. There's a Silence of the Believers on top of the library for Manfield.
Yeah, it's a card we haven't seen a ton of lately, but Hangerback Walker makes exile effects a lot better now than they were a couple of months ago.
Siege Rhino. Most important card in the deck. It's the glue. And that is going to put Sam Black down to 9 and Seth up to 21. He's got lethal damage on the battlefield right now. It's a Nykthos off the top, and that will do it. Seth Manfield advances to the finals of the World Championship, 3-1 over Sam Black. Gentlemen, the matchup didn't look good coming in, and it played out like that too. You know, it just looked like Sam just didn't have the resources he needed at any given stage, and when you looked at the hand plus what was going on board for Seth, he was just ahead the whole time.
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, Sam fought the good fight.
Yeah.
Did what he could, but...
He did pick up a game. You know, I mean, the deck was able to punish a slow draw from Seth Manfield there, but a tough matchup, and it worked out for Seth. He is going to be our first finalist. There's another one to go before we reach to the finals. Let's head back to the news desk and Richard Hagen.
Thanks very much to Marshall, Ian, and Randy there with the call on the first semi-final. Rich alongside Jackie Lee from Inside R&D. Jackie, kind of what we expected, pretty much.
Yeah, I was excited to see that Sam did pull out a game after the first two. I understand that there are a lot of bigger cards in Seth's deck, so I was a little afraid that it was going to end in only 3 games out of 5. So I was happy to see that that didn't happen.
Yeah, hats off to Sam Black, made it in as the 4th seed. Why don't we take a look at our bracket here on Sunday here at PAX, Seattle, the home of Wizards of the Coast. Seth Manfield with Abzan Control, Sam Black with White Devotion. Well, sometimes it does play out as you expect. It did here, and Seth Manfield advances to the final. There we go. And that means we can now turn our attention to the battle between Paul Rietzel with Hangerback Abzan and Owen Turtenwild with Abzan Control. So why don't we take a look at Owen Turtenwild of the United States of America. Let's get a look at his career resume. Qualified here, top pro points at large, the 26-year-old. Of course, he's a platinum pro. He's been that for years. Player of the year, of course, in 2011. 3 Grand Prix titles to his name. Let's see how he did across the 4 formats, because such a stiff examination. 2-1 he opened up in draft, 3-1 in modern, 2-1 back again in limited with Magic Origins, and then in standard, 2-2. And Jackie, the story there, in a way, if we take a look at his round-by-round results, I guess was really the back end of day 2.
Yeah, so I know that Owen primarily was, he was another person who tested extensively on Magic Online, about 12 hours a day.
Right.
But of that, he spent the most time on standard by far, because he felt that, you know, the top 4 is standard, and there's diminishing returns to testing for draft when some of it is about the signals, right?
Yeah, so the vast majority of players here said coming in, what they were interested in was being not second to 24th. And at that point, you focus on standard, which means we should take a look at Owen's standard deck list. Why don't we bring that up for you and show you exactly what Owen is working with. So, Jackie, not everyone got to see the first semi-final where we did have an Abzan control deck victorious. So walk us through everything that Owen is trying to do here.
All right, so he's playing another Abzan control deck. He's got a pretty extensively mixed and variated amount of removal in this deck. So he's got a couple of Bile Blights, a couple of Languish, Murderous Cut, Hero's Downfall, Ultimate Price. So this is for the purposes of, you know, when you draw a few pieces of removal, then you have a higher likelihood that they are diverse and you can pick the threats that you wish to remove with them, because they all have different restrictions. Mm. He's also got the early game and the mid game in Coursers, Den Protectors, Nissa, and Siege Rhino to kind of pull you up from behind, as well as start to press an offensive in the mid game. You will also find that rather than playing the third Elspeth as Seth did, he's playing a Dragonlord Dromoka instead.
Right, so what is the Dragonlord about there? It can't be countered, obviously it's a huge flyer. The opponent can't cast spells on your turn. But what is that? That's the words on the card. But what does it bring to the deck?
Right. So it's a huge life-linking flyer. It's difficult for aggressive decks to deal with it. And against another Abzan deck, with which Owen will be facing, he may find that this will help go over the top. Essentially, it's a huge flying Siege Rhino that gains you, what, like 33% more life per turn?
Right.
So.
Okay, so that's the deck that Owen is dealing with. Now, Owen came in this morning, cool as a cucumber, did a terrific interview with Marshall Sutcliffe. Why don't we take a look at that right now?
Here we are on the eve of the semifinal, and I've got Owen Turtenwald with me here at the Easy Chairs. Welcome, Owen.
What's up?
Mentality, give me a mental game check. You seem calm, cool, and confident to me. Is that how you're feeling?
Yeah, I feel great.
I mean, look, aren't you nervous, dude? Like, this is the world championship. I know how much this means to you. This is, you know, your professional career, since you were young, has mm-hmm. pointed in this direction. You're not feeling it?
Well, no, honestly.
Am I making you nervous?
No. I've, I've played lots of high-stakes matches in my life, and I know that nerves are not going to help me. Nerves are not going to, you know, give me another mana or another point of life. So, you know, and I know that in that spot, you just have to focus on the game and put on your blinders and look at the task ahead.
Now, when you're actually playing the game, you're remarkably well composed at the table. You're very consistent. Your demeanor's the same. Your actions are the same. You treat all your opponents the same. Is that a front? Like, underneath that, are you, like let's say you notice that you made a mistake, or inside are you just like, God, why did I do that? I always do this. Why? Or are you just, like, moving on? Like, are you as cold as you actually look?
No, that's what I strive to be. The kind of person who, when you play against them, you know, when you go to FNM and your opponent's mana screwed, they're like, God dang it, this son of a, they're pounding the table. And it's like, for the person who's playing against them, that's a really uncomfortable, unpleasant experience. And, you know, everyone goes like, oh, sorry about the mana screw, which is understandable. It's not a fun thing to have happen, but I've been on that end of it, and I've been on the end of it in which I'm beating somebody, and I know that nothing I do is going to make my opponent feel any better or feel worse, and so it's all in the game. That's what we all signed up for.
So yesterday you had effectively a day off from World Championship competition. Now, you know, there's a bunch of stuff going on here at PAX as well. How did you feel your day?
Well, I was extremely happy to have a day in which I didn't have to set my alarm. You know, waking up at 8 a.m. and going to play, no matter how you feel, not great. And I was saying in an interview I did yesterday, it's exhausting playing this tournament. This is not a real Magic tournament. It's not like any other kind of Magic tournament, because there's 24 people. If you finish a round left with 20 minutes, they just start another round.
Yeah.
You just are always playing a match. If you get a feature match, they make you wait 10 minutes to start, then the round ends late, the next round starts right away, you're under the hot lights, and everyone's being, you know, deliberate with their plays. It's mentally draining to try to, you know, slog through it.
Because for you as a professional player and somebody who's played in a heck of a lot of high-level Magic tournaments in your life, you get used to that rhythm, right?
Yeah.
You get that in-between time where you get to kind of commiserate with the guys, maybe get a glass of water, you know, sit down for a minute, and you're just lining them up here.
I listened to people who played this tournament for the first time, and they sounded like me the first time I played this tournament, and they're like, wow, like, I had no idea what to expect.
Huh, that's like, crazy. Playtesting. Did you get any testing in yesterday?
I played almost all day. I took about 3-4 hours to look at packs for a little bit and relax, but most of my day was spent playing Magic.
Who'd you test with?
Mike Segrist, Alexander Hain, Jacob Wilson, and I did a lot of communication with William Jensen, Kai Boudé, Reed Duke.
Jeez, nice network of support you
have. No big deal.
Yeah, I was going to say, jeez. Yeah. Hey, I'm in the top four of worlds, and everybody just comes to help Owen out.
It's not bad to pick out your phone and go, hey, how would you sideboard? And they go, give me a minute. Look at the list, give it a long, careful think. And you can pick the brains of just true experts.
Now, what about the matchup that you're actually going to face? You're going to play against Paul Rietzel here. How do you feel about the matchup in general?
Well, Paul played against Seth in Swiss, who Seth played Abzan Control, and he lost. He played against me playing Abzan Control. He lost 0-2 both times. I picked my deck because of a perceived advantage against the Hangerback Abzan deck. Okay. I expected people to play that. So for that reason, I kind of got what I asked for. But Paul is just world-class player. His deck is unusually good for the matchup, and so I expect it to be really close.
Yeah, and Paul Rietzel.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, it's like he is tough.
He's pretty good.
He's not going to give you anything, you know that. Yeah. Any last thoughts as you go in? I mean, how much would it mean to you to pick up a world championship here at this stage of your career?
Well, my friends and peers for a while now have always said Owen is the best player in the world, and deep down I believe it, but then I go to some Grand Prix and some Pro Tours, I've had some pretty, you know, noticeable failures on my end, and I've had some times when I had a good tournament and I've done my best to try to prove them right, but this weekend I have a chance to make it real.
Good luck, Owen.
Thanks.
Welcome back to the news desk here in Seattle for PAX. We're at the World Championship. You just heard it from Owen. one of the best players in the world, and he thinks he knows it, but he wants to prove it here. Now, his opponent for his semifinal match is Paul Rietzel. So what we're going to do is we're going to kind of shift gears and take a look a little closer at what Paul's up to as a player, his tournament, and, of course, his deck as well. Let's take a look at Paul. That's a pretty nice resume he's got there. 29 years old from the United States. Of course, he's a Hall of Famer. He's also a champion, Pro Tour champion. And he's got four Pro Tour top eights as well. Whole lot of money won. This is a thing he hasn't done in Magic, though. He has not won a world championship. Not many can say that they have. And this is going to be a huge push for him here. Let's take a look at his record by format. So this is going to walk us through how many match points he got out of these. And a little bit of a rocky start there. You can see in Modern and in Origins, he picked up three match wins in each of those, a couple in Standard and one in Modern Masters. I wanted to take a look at his round by round. Ian, I wanted you to kind of fill us in on what you see here that stands out to you. You can, the first three rounds there, of course, Modern Masters 2015 draft, he didn't do great at that.
Yeah, a little bit of a rocky start in the Modern Masters portion of the event, going 1-2 in draft there. Did well in Modern with playing Affinity, 3-1, great record there. What really stood out to me in Paul's Swiss portion of the tournament was Day 2 Origins draft.
Uh-huh.
You know, I went down, I was chatting with some of the players, seeing how the draft went for them as they were building their decks, and when I approached Paul's table, he was just absolutely beaming. Had this big smile on his face. I said, Paul, how'd the draft go for you? He said, it went awesome. Take a look at my deck. He laid it out for me. It was nearly mono blue. He had several copies of Void Mage Separatist. Just really solid curve. Looked great. He even had multiple different options he could sideboard in depending on what he was against. And he felt really confident. And as we saw, he ended up going 3-0 there. So that was fantastic.
Yeah, Randy, what stood out for you from his first 2 days of competition?
Well, I mean, for me, the highlight was the last round. I'll get to that in a minute, though. If you look at that 1-3 start, he lost his first round in Modern to Kentaro Yamamoto. And it was Affinity versus Twin. Yamamoto's on Twin. And this is just to give you some indication about the way Paul approaches this game. He was kicking himself. I mean, obviously 1-2, he wasn't happy to be 1-3. There was this moment in that match against Kentaro where Kentaro casts a Pyroclasm, right? Paul's got Arcbound Ravager, and crucially, he's got a Spellskite. That's how he's going to defend himself against the whole Splinter Twin combo with a Spellskite. So it's like, okay, Pyroclasm, he's got a Spellskite. The Ravager's going to make the Spellskite into a 1-5. And Paul's like, should I sack this Darksteel Citadel so that I can get two copies, two +1/+1 counters onto the Spellskite? Because it's 6 toughness,
uh-huh.
It would survive any Lightning Bolt that Kentaro might have in his hand. But if Kentaro has an Ancient Grudge, this is a catastrophe. I've just thrown away one of my lands for no good reason, right? This is where the edges are at the World Championships. It's like, okay, he's pyroclasming me to kill your Ravager. Do you turn your land into a 1-6 Spellskite? And he decided not to sack the land.
Okay.
Yamamoto has the Lightning Bolt. Bolts the Spellskite, untaps, you know, combos him off.
Wow.
And just Paul was killing himself. He's like, that's where the edges are in this tournament. Like, can you figure out, like, two plays later, he's pyroclasm, he's got the bolt, he's got the combo. And yeah, that's, so if you would follow Paul on social media, you saw he was just killing himself. Like, I just threw this match away. And it's like, you know, I punted this match.
Yeah.
You talk about punting this match, you think somebody, oh, they just, you know, missed something. Like, it's, no, it's like 3-4 cards and 3 turns down the road, there was this edge I could have had. I could have had the +1/+1 counter. So you go to day two and...
Well, you know, to round up day one, Randy, not to interrupt you here, but he finds himself at 1-3 and then also in classic Paul Rietzel fashion, rattles off 3 wins in a row and then 3 to come back for 6 wins in a row total before finally taking another loss to Seth Manfield there, who just kind of beat everybody in day one. But, you know, all of a sudden he's right back in the thick of it.
He is right back in the thick of things. And then he 3-0s the draft that Ian was talking about. So he goes to Standard in pretty good shape. I mean, he winds up 1-2 in the first two rounds of Standard, but because of the 6 wins in a row, comes to the last round, he's playing against Martin Mueller. This game 3, if you guys haven't gone, didn't see it live, go back and watch game 3 of Paul Rietzel versus Martin Mueller.
Yeah, you have to.
It is insane. Paul is dead. For 5 turns, he's dead. Now, this is after he had game 2 won multiple times, I thought. Like, Paul wins the first game. Second game, Martin Mueller comes out and Paul thought seizes his entire hand away,
Martin top decks an Ashiok.
Yeah, yeah.
Not only top decks the Ashiok, but hits like two Fleece Manes. And
he hit three creatures off of it.
And Anafenza. Yeah. So it's like, okay, fine, Martin top deck. So Paul then wins that game, you know, against all the Ashioks. And Paul comes back and Martin top decks him again to actually win the game. It's like, yeah, okay,
it was super exciting. You have to watch it. Definitely check it out. I want to talk about his deck.
I want to talk about game three.
I'm sorry, Randy. I have to. They have to go look at it. They can check it out on the YouTube channel.
Well, to be continued.
To be continued. But we do have a lot of time here before their match starts, so I want to get an idea for what you guys think of this Hangerback Abzan deck. This is, of course, the breakout deck from Grand Prix London. And this thing, I think, had a big target on it coming in, actually, as we've seen some of the players say, well, I wanted to be able to beat this deck, but Paul chose to play it. What do you think about this deck, Randy?
I mean, it's good. Look, I mean, it didn't dominate Grand Prix London for no reason. You know, first, second, two more in the top eight, ninth, and it has just become probably the best deck in Standard lately. Like you say, though, had the target on its forehead. It's basically the old Abzan aggro deck, but with Hangerback Walkers in where the Rakshasa Death Dealers used to be. And it's just that Hangerback Walker gives the deck so much more resiliency against removal. It's a great deck.
Yeah.
It's aggressive, which plays to Paul's strengths, but definitely had the target on its forehead.
Did you expect to see a lot of this deck here, Ian? It's hard, you know, when there's a known quantity deck, right, that's everybody knows that it's good, and you got to figure that everybody else is going to have this deck in mind. It makes it, you know, less likely that you actually want to play it.
Yeah, I think this version of Abzan with the Hangerback Walkers, it was really successful at the Grand Prix level, and I don't think that's a coincidence. I think the way that Paul has configured his deck with the Hangerbacks is great against a broad field where you're not sure what to expect. You're going to be against a lot of the decks on the fringes. I don't think it's as effective against other Abzan decks, and I think that given the way the field played out here this weekend and going up against Owen Turtenwald's more controlling Abzan deck, I don't think this configuration is as effective as it would be in a more open field.
Okay, and that's something that we're, of course, going to keep our eye on is how this matchup actually plays out. But I actually had a chance to sit down a little earlier today with Paul Rietzel and get his take on it directly from him and also check in with him on how he's feeling. Let's hear it from Paul himself. All right before his semifinal match, I've got Paul Rietzel with me here on the easy chairs. Welcome, Paul.
Thank you, appreciate it.
First temperature check here. How are you feeling? Are you nervous?
You know, I feel good. I'd be lying if I said I wasn't a little bit nervous. I don't normally get nervous for top eight matches, but you know, the World Championships is a cut above. I mean, just the tournament itself, I know how hard it is to get these opportunities. And even after a pro tour, you feel like, well, there's another pro tour coming, you know? But World Championship, you don't know if you're ever going to get another shot like this. So I wouldn't say nervous, but definitely, you know, feel the emotions starting to rise up a little bit.
Yeah, because you just, I mean, you've had a long, successful career in the Hall of Fame. You've experienced success at the highest levels that the game has to offer, you know, pro tour champion and all that. But this is a little different, right? Yeah. These ones are so hard to get to that you know I might not get another chance at this. So I'm not surprised to hear that you feel it a little bit more.
Yeah, and I'm 30 years old. You know, I'm entering the family portion of my life. So you know, I would love the chance to really cap off my career with something like this. You know, where I could look back and say, wow. You know, like for one weekend at least I was the best player in the world or close to it, so you know I would love to win, and hopefully I can do it.
Now, how do you feel about your chances to do so, right? And I'm talking about matchups wise. Mm-hmm. You're going to be playing against Owen Turtenwald in your semifinal match, one of the best players in the world. He's not going to give you anything.
Yeah,
how are you feeling?
Yeah, no, it's tough. You know, Owen is arguably the best player in the world right now, and certainly in the top three. Played phenomenally when I played against him yesterday. Seems to be prepared, sharp, at the top of his game with a tuned deck list. So I think if you were to construct someone you didn't want to play against in a tournament, that's what I'm playing against in the first
the
round.
Magic Terminator.
Yeah, exactly. So
yeah, but you're no slouch yourself.
No, yeah, I think I'm the rightful underdog in the match, but certainly don't feel like I have no chance. More than a fighter's chance. I think I'm a slight underdog. So,
okay.
You know, we'll see what happens. I think that it being best of five as opposed to best of three is probably good for me to play more post-cyborg games. But, you know, we'll see. I don't have any special potion or tricks to kind of to get Owen. But if you have any, I'm open to any ideas.
I don't have any. Okay. I'm sorry. I don't think there are any. Testing? Who did you test with? Did you have people on site here for yesterday? You guys had a day off on Saturday?
Yeah, so I didn't want to get too crazy playing yesterday. You know, even though there are some card choices that are unique and mine has more two drops and Owen's is more controlling, we're still functionally playing an Abzan mirror with cards that I'm very familiar with. So I didn't think it'd be a good use of my time to blast my brain playing 10 hours of the same match. I reached out to Team Ultra Pro, leveraged that resource, mentioned some suggestions regarding strategy and sideboarding, got feedback from, you know, Bob Maher and Rich Hohen and Ben Stark and Matt Sperling, David Williams and all these people. Andrew Beckstrom helped me a lot last night, you know, when we did play a few of the post-sideboard games to see how that would play out. But, you know, ultimately I came up with a plan that I'm pretty happy with. I'm very confident in the way that I'm going to sideboard. And, you know, there are certain things Owen can do that throw wrenches in the plan, and we discussed those as well. So, you know, rather than just trial and error, trying to bang my head against the wall until the answer popped out, I collaborated again with that team and leaned on them to help me figure out, you know, how to adjust.
How much of is it for you finding that balance here, right? You know, you said you didn't want to go play for 10 hours and come in today just frazzled.
Right.
How much is it for you for finding a balance between keeping your mental game happy and playing games?
It's huge, you know. I think that I'm at my best when I'm focused, but relaxed. You know, if I get too much into my own head, you know, it's not a good thing. So yesterday I went for a run. We went to Pike Place, the fish market. We went to the original Starbucks. We walked all around the city. My fiance, Kat, and I looked at some pictures of our cats, Cookie and Monster. Just all things to just kind of like relax and settle myself. And
that sounds
and make
like
sure.
A nice day.
It was a great day. Yeah, you know, I didn't let magic stray too far from my mind, but again, I didn't want it weighing me down. You know. So you know, it was a nice, balanced, relaxing day. Got a great night's sleep. And ultimately, there's no tricks, like I said before. We're functionally playing with cards that have been the good cards in Standard for a while now. And both of us have great decks, you know, and are ready for this particular matchup. And we'll just see how we play and how the cards fall.
What would it mean to you to win a world championship? You've accomplished basically everything else that you can in Magic. What would it mean to you to get a world championship on your resume?
I don't know. It's difficult to even put into words. You know, I think that, you know, a lot of people, they have dreams. You know, I dream of hitting a home run or making the major leagues, or I dream of playing on the Pro Tour, winning a Pro Tour. I never dreamed of winning a world championship until last night. Last night's the first night that I thought, well, this could really happen. You know what I mean? And I realized, wow, I am, you know, six games wins away from winning a world championship. So it's difficult to even conceptualize or describe what it's like, because it just doesn't seem like an attainable goal for anyone, even the elite players. It's just so high up there. And I mean, what is it? No American world champion since John Finkel.
It's been a
so,
long time.
So that's company that I would love to join. And you know, like I said, you know, I'm certainly closer to the end of my career than to the beginning, and to be able to accomplish that and like I said, put that cherry on top of what's been an amazing run would be just an incredible honor and certainly, you know, the greatest accomplishment of my life so far.
Well, Paul, I want to wish you luck in your goal of winning the world championship.
Thank you.
Previously on episode 14 of Paul Rietzel, Amazing Magic Player, we heard Randy Bueller discussing games 1 and 2 against Martin Muller. Now, the conclusion.
This game, Paul is dead, right? His opponent has like 14 power worth of dragons. Silumgar has stolen Tassigar. This is game 3 with top 4 on the line against 17-year-old Martin Muller. Dragon Lord Silumgar, Paul's Tassigar, and all Paul has is a Fleecebane Lion. Now, Martin is at 10, but Paul's got Fleece, so he top decks Den Protector. And, you know, I talked to Paul afterwards, and he said this may be the best match of Magic he's ever played in his entire life, the closest he's ever had to a perfect game, because he plays the Den Protector, and Martin knows it's a Den Protector. Now Martin flips, activates his Tassigar. And so here's the key moment. Paul's thinking about the Tassigar, except he's not actually thinking. What he's doing is he figured out this plan with Martin on 10. He needs Martin to cast the Thought Seize and pay 2 life to have any chance. Because Paul's already figured out that he's going to use Den Protector to regrow a Johnny. He's going to put 3 +1/+1 counters on a Den Protector to make it unblockable. That's going to hit for 6. And then the only chance he's got is to then top deck Siege Rhino to do 3 more, right? That's the line he's come up with. He needs Martin to play this Thought Seize. So he thinks and he agonizes, and Thought Seize is the obvious card to give him on the Tassigar, but Paul needs to make it look like
he doesn't want to give him the Thoughtseize. He's got to think of other things, and then begrudgingly hands Martin the Thoughtseize, which Martin promptly casts, pays two life. Paul does his Den Protector shenanigans, and maybe Martin should have killed the Den Protector so that it could never get the plus three counters. But, I mean, this is Paul just looking for any way to win this game, and he just stitches together this winning line out of nowhere, hits for six with unblockable Den Protector, top of the deck, there's the Siege Rhino, through to the top four. Just an unbelievable game of Magic. And Paul, so far ahead of it, he'd already figured out what the plays were, but, like, how long do you think to represent things? He's going to need another great match of Magic here. He maybe is not a favorite, but this is one guy I just love watching.
Well, you get your wish, Randy Buehler. It is time right here, right now, for Owen Turtenwald against Paul Rietzel in the second semifinal of the Magic the Gathering World Championship 2015.